a number of times answering the tough questions in Judaism. It's kind of a tongue-in-cheek, of course, as you can tell from the flyer and from the advertisement that we sent out. But, you know, we always do some very heavy classes like Kabbalah and Talmud. So every once in a while, since I'm a very serious guy, every once in a while I like to open it up a little bit to something more light within Judaism, because as we've always talked about, that Jews by nature are not normal. I mean, we have to be a little bit mishuk, and it's actually in the Torah, you know, when Moses is talking to God, I mean, after the golden calf, and he keeps complaining, Amkshe Ayrev, God says, this is a stubborn, stiff-necked people. Well, of course, a stubborn, stiff-necked people. I mean, look at everything you made them do, God. I mean, you know, just this portion, I mean, with Abraham acquiescing without really much debate about circumcision. I mean, you know, I mean, just that should give you a little bit of an insight of what kind of a people, you know, we are. And the fact that, you know, we are here when the majority of nations that we talk about throughout our history are in the dustbins, you know, are all gone, just says something about the Jews, that they're a little bit quirky, they're a little bit stubborn. I mean, they march to the beat of their own drummer. When the entire Roman world was converting to Christianity, there was but yet just one people that just refused to convert. And ironically, it was Jesus' own people. I mean, this wasn't, you know, it wasn't the Germans, and it wasn't the Indians, but it was actually the Jews who actually grew up with him and refused to convert to Judaism, or to convert to Christianity. So it talks a lot about what we're made up. So we have a lot of these idiosyncrasies that we've taken and picked up along the way from Moses all the way to the United States of America. Now, with that being said, is on the flip side, we are experts in assimilation. I mean, you know, we adapt like a chameleon to no matter what, where we are in the world. I mean, we're in Russia, we're Russians. If we're in Argentina, we're Argentinians. We're Iran, we're Iran, we're Persians. I mean, we're all over the world. I mean, we know first and foremost that we gotta survive. That's the name of the game. So we walk in this very fine line of what we call, what's that illness when you have split personalities?
Schizophrenia.
So we walk this very fine line of schizophrenia, you know, where, you know, on one hand, where visa Christel zach yidl zach, we say in the Yiddish expression, the way the Christian world goes, the Jews follow along, and at the same time, we try our best not to follow along and to blaze our own trail, which obviously lends to a lot of different psychosis within the Jewish community, like guilt and all of the other stuff that, you know, that we have. I mean, you know, the difference between an Italian grandmother and a Jewish grandmother. We talked about this on Shabbos. An Italian grandmother will tell her grandson, Tony, if you don't eat the macaroni, I'm gonna kill you. And a Jewish grandmother will say, Yanko, if you don't eat the macaroni, I'll kill myself. Right? I mean, you know, so all of that stuff starts early on, and now we wonder why we have neurotic Jewish doctors. You know, I mean, and, you know, all that stuff. But they tell the story of, you know, a report that came out that was devastating in a scientific report, that because of the ozone layer, and, you know, we know what's going on here with global warming, that in a short while the polar ice cap is going to melt. Now, you know what happens if the polar ice cap melts? I mean, the Arctic Ocean floods, and if the Arctic Ocean floods, then what happens? It flows into the Atlantic Ocean, which then flows into the Pacific Ocean. Everything's going to flood. It's going to make this tsunami look like, you know, like a day at the beach. And before you know it, all of civilization that we know is going to be gone. And unfortunately, we don't have much time. This is all going to happen in a matter of 3 weeks. 3 weeks? I mean, you got to be kidding. 3 weeks? Okay. So what do you do? So all of the nations in the world, I mean, are starting to think, what are you doing in 3 weeks? So all the Catholics come to a major address by the Pope. And the Pope says, listen, fellas, we got 3 weeks to repent. And because we're going to see our Maker, we're going to stand in front of God in judgment. You better get your houses in order. And, you know, and all the Anglicans listen to a major address by the Archbishop of Canterbury, where he says, repeats basically the same message. We're all going to meet our Maker in 3 weeks. We just better take care of business. And, of course, the imams out of Saudi Arabia, and the Ayatollahs in Persia, and all of the spiritual leaders in India, and Well, the Jews get together in Jerusalem. I mean, like everybody else, and they're all standing there, and the little rabbi, chief rabbi of Israel, gets up and he says, "Brothers and sisters, we have 3 weeks had to learn to live underwater." Right? Because no matter what, we are going to survive. We're going to survive. Which brings us to tonight's topic, tough questions to ask the rabbi. Now, I threw up a few questions because which I thought about, you know, in the introduction, but of course tonight's real test is going to be questions from the audience. Can you hear me in the back? Yeah, you back there. We want you to throw out, you know, some questions. So I'm just going to start with, you know, some of these ideas that we talked about, but I only want to use that as kind of a springboard for you if you have any questions that you would like to discuss. And it doesn't have to be anything really heavy. I mean, even the most curious question is also a good question. I'm going to start with question number 5, which, you know what, I mean, I wanted a birth announcement. And the local paper had, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Sandler, you know, will want to announce the birth of our son, Dr. Charles Sandler. You know, we know. So, I mean, that would give you just an idea of what we're talking about over here. And are all Jewish children brilliant? Or what am I going to say? You know, I have 6 geniuses, you know, 6 Einsteins that, you know what, I mean, just compete against each other for the Nobel Prize, etc., etc. There is an underlying idea behind this question, because as we all know, one of the cornerstones of the Jewish religion is education. It's part and parcel. You can't get away with, we are called people of the book. Now, when we read the Shema, I mean, one of the first things that it tells you is that you have to teach it unto your children. And this has become so, so important within Judaism, that the theme of education to our youth, regardless of, you know, whether it's a secular education or religious education, but a child has to be educated. There's no such thing. I mean, very, very few Jews, even if they were poor, even if they themselves didn't have much of an education, wanted their children to be educated. Because education shows that, you know, that eventually you can have a future, and a future means to make a living, and a living means survival, and survival means that there's going to be grandchildren. And really, isn't that really what we're all about? Living long enough to have grandchildren. That's what it was all about. So they used to say, when I think most of us are from Eastern European extract, I mean, we all were Ashkenazim primarily, and they used to say that a child in Poland of 5 could read better than the average Polish citizen, because, you know, he knew right away early on that this is the way it's going to be, this is the way he's going to go. Now, with the opening up of civilization, the Enlightenment, and then the Renaissance, and, you know, and the bringing down of barriers, and Jews were allowed to go to university, I don't have to tell you what happened. As soon as they smelled that this is a way out of the ghetto, many of them actually took the route to go to universities and to become great scholars. I mean, we always talk about, and Spinoza's a favorite of ours that we always talk about here at the shul, but not only Spinoza, but other great, you know, other great scientists.
Do you know
scholars.
Why that is?
Why?
To get out of the ghetto?
Why?
They couldn't play basketball.
There you go. That was it. Yeah, that's also true. That's also true. So they had to get out somehow. So the way out is like what you were talking about is, you know what the definition, you know when you realize that you're Jewish? The moment that it dawns upon you that you're more likely to own a basketball team than be one of the players. So that's when you finally realize I must be Jewish. You know, just to add on to your Bob's thought over there. And that led, you know, to, of course, you know, establishing many of our own universities, such as Brandeis University here in the United States, in Israel, even against all odds, built 5 major universities. And that has been part and parcel of Jewish theme throughout the ages, that you must teach your children. Why? Because Moses encourages and urges the Jewish people at the time of the giving of the Torah, for this will be your wisdom and your understanding to the eyes of the world. That by you studying, this is going to differentiate between who we are and who they are. Well, yeah, they are who they are. They're the boors. They know nothings of the world. But we know something. Now, unfortunately, what happened is that the scale started to tip here in the United States. Whereas in Eastern Europe, you know, people prided themselves on being kind of scholarship and knowing how to at least to read Hebrew, something. Here, Jewish education, not secular education, I'm primarily talking about Jewish education, began to wane. I mean, because people really didn't appreciate and didn't understand the relevance. I mean, you know, many came from Eastern Europe, lived in this down in a ghetto called the Lower East Side, had one thought in mind, that their children will get out. I mean, you know, with a million people living in a small little area, it was stifling. I mean, if you had relatives or grandparents, great grandparents, you know, grew up over there, and how to get out of this ghetto, how to get out of here, was through education, but not by learning Chumash. I mean, and Gemara, Talmud is certainly not going to get you out here. But what's going to get you out is either a medical degree, a law degree, a financial degree, some management classes. And that became primarily the focus of the American Jewish community. And I would dare say, and I would bet, that we are probably right now at, not talking about the yeshiva world and all of that world, but just a general American Jewish community, at probably one of the lowest points in Jewish knowledge. Because an average American Jew is so unknowledgeable, so ignorant of what Judaism is all about. I mean, you know, if you ask, just to take a sampling of American Jews, not the shulgoers, what makes you Jewish? And we've talked about this a number of times. We don't believe in Jesus. I mean, that's what unites us. And what about going to temple? What about studying? That's to me not relevant. I mean, but I don't believe in Jesus. I mean, that's what makes me Jewish. So this trend of the importance of Torah study has waned. Although, you know, like everything else, it's having a renaissance now, even among Reform and non-Orthodox Jews, because people begin to realize. I'm a creature of habit, and you know, and if it moves around too much, and people begin to realize that going so far away from Judaism is really throwing out the baby with the bathwater. So I think that more people are now beginning to come back a little bit towards ritual, and ritual begats study, because, you know, if you want to put on a mezuzah, why? Well, why should we put them? Oh, so that leads to discussion and open forums. And I think more and more people will begin to see the beauty, you know, within Judaism, and what Judaism is relevant even here in the United States. And then we won't have to say, are all Jewish children brilliant? Of course they are. I mean, that's by nature the thought. I think you wanted to say something, Mr.
Oh, the one school I thought you forgot was Yale.
Oh, Yale? That they didn't go to, Jews, or Jews did go to?
It was started because they couldn't get into schools of that.
Was country. Yale started this way?
Yeah, and Shield has Hebrew
letters. Yeah, no, I know the Shield has Hebrew letters, but I always thought the Shield had Hebrew letters, because, oh, go, no, not. You see Yale, produced the President of the United States.
That's right.
Two of them.
Two of them. But Bob is most proud of the present President of the United States. Yes, and then, you know, Yale, and of course, I mean, a number of different schools, you know, throughout, but, I was at Brandeis University. I was at Yale also, but I was at Brandeis University, and Abraham Sacker, I mean, the first president of Brandeis University, you know, was a great fundraiser. He raised personally over $200 million to build Brandeis, and they say, yeah, he was just unbelievable. I mean, besides being a great historian and a scholar, and he also was a tremendous fundraiser. I mean, the word in Brandeis was that if you stand around too long, you'll have a plaque on you, so keep moving, because like every single thing had a plaque there. I mean, from the urinals to the tables, I mean, everything was some kind of dedication. And he actually wrote a book, if you can get a hold of it, it's a pretty interesting book. It's called The Host at Last, that, you know, where he describes the reason why he started Brandeis and why they found it, because they couldn't get into Harvard and, you know, in all of these places that had quotas. You know, I mean, but there were Jews in Brandeis. I mean, I'm sorry, there were Jews in Harvard.
They had
courses in Hebrew, you know, strictly.
There was a very big quota system.
Yeah, there was a big quota system, and they took few Jews, even though that the first 15 Harvard commencements were given in Hebrew. I mean, the commencement speeches were given in Hebrew, and at the early part of this last century, there was a great scholar there. I mean, a tremendous scholar, Harry Wolfson. Harry Wolfson is, again, an interesting study in scholarship. I mean, we're talking about brilliance. He was a Misnagit. He went to a Slobodka yeshiva. He was probably Lithuanian, or at least came from Lithuanian stock. You know, he went to Slobodka. He left at the age of 12, came here to America, and his name was then Herschel Astriner, because Herschel was his Hebrew name, and Astrid was the name of the town he came from. Going across the border, he ended up Harry Wolfson. He didn't know anything else, so he ended up in Harvard, and he became the Jewish presence in Harvard. And his autobiography, again, I mean, if somebody's interested in this, I mean, to pick up Harry Wolfson's autobiography, he tells a story that at one of the main meetings, you know, he was a schlumpy guy. I mean, he never married. He never got married. He was a schlumpy dresser. I mean, on campus, everybody knew him by his scholarship, not by the way he looked at Harvard. You know, at least administration prided themselves, they're blue blood. I mean, you know, these are aristocrats. And so at one time, they invited this Wolfson because they wanted to show off some of the presidents. So they had this meeting of all the big mucky mucks, all the big fundraisers, the big money. I mean, Gentiles, Protestants, I mean, all of them sitting in the crowd, and they invited in Harry Wolfson to address the crowd. So he gets up and he speaks like this, 15 minutes in Greek, 15 minutes in Hebrew, and then 15 minutes in English. And when they asked him, Harry, I mean, why 15 minutes in Greek and Hebrew? So he wanted to tell them, I wanted to show them what a Jewish pisher knows. I mean, you know, that was his answer. I mean, you know, this is now they're going to sit over there with all the money, but I'm going to show them what a Jewish pisher can do. And you know, and I knew people that knew Harry Wolfson because I was lived in Boston for 8 years, and he said that he once, he was this great scholar, and he once, like, I think Saturday morning about like 12 o'clock was hanging around downtown Boston and saw Wolfson come out of a movie theater that was showing the Marx Brothers. So he ran over to him and said, Wolfson, the Marx Brothers, I mean, you, how did you get to the Marx Brothers? You know, these are those days they were playing in the theater. So he says, you know, now I'm not Wolfson. Now I'm not the Wolfson from Harvard. I'm just Harry, the guy who likes Marx Brothers, you know. And he invited him over to his house. And it was a small little apartment in Cambridge. And he opened up his oven and there was books in the oven. I mean, that's when, I mean, there was books all over the house. I mean, there's piles and piles of books, but he went into his oven and he opened up his oven. Inside the oven, there were more books. And so this was not typical, because you had to be a Harry Wolfson to be like that, but he wrote a major works on Spinoza, major works on the Kalam, on the Kalam was the medieval system of Islamic philosophy. Now, why would a guy write like a huge tome on the medieval system of Islamic philosophy? He called it his Vietnam. What did he mean by that? Is that he was once doing, because he wrote on Maimonides, a huge text on Maimonides, and he was doing some research on the Kalam, you know, because Maimonides had interfaced and connections with Islamic scholars in the Middle Ages. And then all of a sudden, this is the way his mind worked. He read one paper and then another paper on the Kalam, and slowly but surely he spent 15 years researching it. At the end, he said he called it his Vietnam. It was like, you know, started out as this, you know, quote unquote, a little war. You know, we're sending only a few advisors, and ended up sending 550,000 American troops, you know, to Vietnam. And this is what happened to him. And he actually produced this huge volume of the, you know, on the Kalam. That was the kind of scholarship that Jews had. But as we were saying before, that there were a lot of restrictions getting into Harvard, and that's why. We have these other universities, you know, around the country. But certainly education was always and continues and hopefully will continue to be a focal point of, you know, of Jewish existence, because you can't get to another generation with ignorance, because ignorance begets, you know, just begets apathy. I mean, if you don't know anything, you're just apathetic to it. I mean, like, take for example cricket. You know, I'm a sports fan. I know nothing about cricket, and I could care less if they never played another cricket game in the world. I mean, if cricket all of a sudden disappeared, forget about it. Now, hockey was a devastating year last year for me. I mean, you know what I mean? I woke up every day looking at the paper for hockey scores, and no hockey scores. You know, it was a year of mourning. It was I was saying Kaddish last year, you know, every day. But now, Baruch Hashem, the resurrection of the dead. This came back just to show you that Maimonides' principle of the resurrection of the dead could be true, because you see the NHL is back up. But if you're ignorant of this, you don't care. It's just you're apathetic to it. It's going to disappear. And then I feel it's true among many American Jews that, you know, because they don't understand the beauty of what Judaism is, they just, you know, let it slip by, and it becomes irrelevant to them.
Question.
I'll make a point. Yeah.
The emphasis on education, particularly secular education,
okay,
for people who came to the Lower East Side and wherever. Mm-hmm. One of the problems that I see with that is there was so much push to become a professional, whatever it was, to be a success, that it neglected the individual. You had to be a doctor, you had to be a lawyer, an Indian chief, whatever it was. What did the kid want to do?
Now, who cares?
That was the problem.
Who cares?
That's my point.
Yeah. Well, see, in those days, this was pre-60s. See, the 60s, we began to realize, oh, there's actually individuals living in this country, because the 50s were homogenized. In the 50s, were all everybody being track houses grew up. Look over here in California, all track houses began to pop up. Suburbia, everybody had to have that. But I remember everybody bought this car to Bonneville for some odd reason. Every Jew owned a Bonneville, a Pontiac, huge Bonneville. None of the Jews knew how to drive. I mean, I had one uncle in our family that knew how to drive. He's had like a middle of the front seat like this. You know, whenever we were like on a trip, you could fit 45 people in Bonneville. But it was some experience. But no one cared. Especially till World War II, certainly not. I mean, you just did what your parents told you to do, and that's the way it was. After World War II, the 60s came along, Benjamin Spock, and, you know, difference, the hippie movement, that already started to talk about, hey, what about my feelings? You know, what about me? What about me? Before then, if your father said to you, you know what, you're going to go to Harvard, you're going to go to college, you just listened.
No, whether you liked it or not.
Whether you liked it or not.
I understand. That's the way it was.
That's the way it was. You know, and that's...
But it still didn't take into consideration what the kid wanted.
No,
what his feelings were,
No one cared, because to them it was so obvious. It was so obvious that the kid wants to be a doctor. I mean, which kid doesn't want to be a doctor? You have to be like crazy. You have to be like a Gentile, Episcopalian. What do you want to be? You're gonna be like a newspaper reporter? What kind of job is that, a newspaper reporter?
And it's also because the Tata said.
Yeah, that was also.
And the mama said, and that's what you did.
And that's what you did. I mean, we often talk about here in class. You know what? When I grew up in yeshiva, you know what? I mean, it was, you couldn't go if your teacher hit you, which was a common practice in our days. There was no refuge at your house. It wasn't like, you know, if your teacher hit you, you ran home, you would get sympathy. Maybe your mother would give you sympathy, but your father, your teacher hit you, you probably deserved it. I mean, that was the name of the game. It wasn't like, you know, okay, let's get a lawyer, we're gonna sue the school. There was no such things, because in those days, personal feelings didn't matter. We have a goal that we want to reach, and I tell you, certainly I know with Holocaust survivors, I mean, there you're talking about, which I grew up, this is my milieu, my specialty, because when I taught Saturday night at the Holocaust, we did that every Saturday night, we would get together with the relatives. By then, there was not a, you're not going to go to college? I mean, this was like, you're not going to have like a bar mitzvah? Which kind of, what are you, a goy? You're not going to have a bar mitzvah. I mean, even the most irreligious person did a certain thing. You had a bar mitzvah, you went to college, you made a living. Yeah, if you didn't make a living, even like Jackie Mason jokes around, even the guys who weren't professionals, if you were a truck driver, your mother always claimed, oh, you know, you're like, you run a trucking company. I mean, you know what, you're not a truck driver, you commandeer this big thing. You're a commandeer, you're a manager over something.
It's in transportation.
That's it, finished. Right? It used to be a garbage picker when I was a kid. People picked up garbage. No, a sanitation engineer. Right. Now it's a sanitation. But in those days, it didn't matter, because to them, it was, we know what's best for you.
Oh, I understand that.
Yeah.
The whole attitude, the whole approach.
But
yes, I realize where it's coming from, yeah. but it totally neglected.
But you know what? I'll tell you something, Mom. It's interesting, because today we've swung the opposite. Today we're encouraging, you know, talk about your feelings, find out who you are.
I'm not talking about that.
No, I understand, but you know what? In those days, even, forget about even education. even within, no matter, society didn't care that much, and it wasn't such a great emphasis on what you wanted. For example, marriage. Today we have a no-fault divorce. Today, 50% of all marriages we know that are gonna happen in the next 2 or 3 years will sooner or later end up in divorce. Now, well, some of them are legitimate. I mean, some people should have never got married to begin with, they're opposites, forget about it, it shouldn't have ever happened. But many of them are, I believe, fixable. I mean, there could be reconciliation, but today it's a different game, because I take into consideration what I want, what makes me happy, and we live in such a fast-paced world today. You know, everything is instant gratification, and if I'm not getting it at home, what I want, what I need, and the same thing is true for her, then you know what, it's over. In the olden days, no one thought about that. You know, it was a divorce was, unless it was a rarity. So I think all of this, society was different in those days, and no one, and our parents knew it's good for you, and this is what you're gonna do, and there's nothing to talk about, and we don't care if you're miserable or not miserable, you're gonna be a doctor because eventually you'll come to love us.
A nation and a religion that is so based in ethics and morality.
Yeah, this is morality. This is morality. We're gonna give you, since even in the Talmud it says, there are three things that a father has to do for his children. Okay, there it says his sons, but we're gonna expand it here, you know, to America, you know, we'll just change it a little bit, to his children, right? One thing is he's gotta teach them Torah. Second, he has to teach them how to swim. I guess in those days it was an important thing to learn how to swim so you don't drown. And the third thing is he has to teach them how to make a living. And if he doesn't do these three things, it's as if he's feeding him poison. Now, okay, so let's take the first one. First one is teaching them Torah, which is, go send them Torah. Either teach them yourself or get them a teacher. Teach them how to swim is, you know, you go out to school, get someone in, teach them how to swim, fine. Let's talk about making a living, because that's the toughest one of all. So, in the Hasidic movement, which one of the questions is about the Hasidic movement, fur hats, which shun secular education, they don't go to college. What does that mean? That means that either you're going to be a rabbi, whether you like it or not, so they're going to push you towards that stream, or we're going to teach you, like, you know, how to cut diamonds, how to do this, how to do that, how to, now it's expanded to computer work, you know, everything that you don't need much secular education for. But if you're a secular Jew, you know, and you want your child to really succeed, what are the options? You've got to send them to college, because without college, you're not going to be able to get a job. And if you're not going to be able to get a job, you'll be a schlepper. And you'll be a schlepper, it's going to be a black mark on the family. And what am I going to say to all of my friends? Well, you know, what are you? You're going to be a manager of an In-N-Out? God forbid, move to California if that's what you're going to be. So at least you'll be out of sight, out of mind. You know, and that was the attitude of the people. That was the attitude of the parents, that they're gonna make sure that you succeed. But I don't wanna go to medical school. Who asked you? No one asked you, and this is the way, you know, you don't, okay. Like he says, if you were smart, you went to medical school. If you weren't that smart, you went to law school. If you were retarded, you became an accountant. I mean, that's, you know, those were the three options.
I want to add to what he said, but yeah, in a different way. Before the 60s, or even before that, the Jewish mother was a factor to the question of whether all Jewish children are geniuses.
Right.
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 So if a child was good or bad, it doesn't matter, smart or not smart, the mother then would say, my child is a genius. Today it's not like this. I know that for me, my mother always said that I was a genius, no matter what I did.
Right.
It doesn't matter if I was good in math, bad in math, I was lousy in math, still I was a genius. But nowadays, I hear mothers, and they say, I don't think he's such a genius. He really needs to do this, he needs to learn that. It's a different
mentality.
Yeah,
but even with all that, I think even still today, there's still not as overt the pressure, but I think there's still the subtle pressure among the generation that's come out of the 40s and 50s. I just take, for example, not my family, because, you know, we live in a different world, but for example, take my sister, who's non-Orthodox. She's not Orthodox. My brother-in-law is a surgeon, and she has two sons. Now, I don't remember my sister putting pressure on her sons to go to medical school. And they grew up with a father, which would lead me to say that they would reject medicine because he was hard, you know, he was always busy running surgery back and forth, coming late, waking up in the middle of the night. But subtly, subtly, very subtly, this became part and parcel, and they're both doctors. Both of my nephews, one is already a pediatrician, and the other one is going to medical school now, because I think that my sister, still the old-fashioned mom, who's very, you know, when he graduated from medical school, you know, she called me 6 times to tell me he got his degree, and then they come into his room, there's nothing else there. She threw everything else out, because he got married at the same time. She threw everything else out, but only one thing remains in his room. A certificate like this from McGill University saying, MD. And you know, so I said, you couldn't make it any bigger, Anna. I mean, why don't you just like plaster the wall at the other? She would have. She said, oh, it's a good idea. Maybe, no. That's still the attitude. That's still the attitude of the Jewish people. And I think a lot of it has to do with the survivability of the Jewish people, of being ingrained in our minds that if you have something in hand, you'll survive. You're never going to go hungry. Because you know, my sister and I came out of Holocaust parents who starved for 5 years. I mean, they had nothing to eat. I mean, and worse than that, Auschwitz, and, you know, the whole nine yards. And this was drilled into our heads that you have to make a living. You got to make a living because that's, you know, that's the way it goes.
So how do you explain then the Orthodox Hasidim,
yeah,
who really send their kids only to learn Torah,
right,
or nothing?
Because to them,
mommies.
Good. That's a very good question. Because to them, their whole outlook on life is very different. Their Weltanschauung is completely different. They don't see the world in the same glasses as the secular Jewish community sees the world. They see the world in black and white. See, most people see the world in a gray area. You know what? Even though we know we're like Bob had mentioned, we are a nation of morals and ethics, but generally people, we see life in very gray terms. You know what? Nothing is stark, black and white for us. You know what? People are good, people are bad, there's good things in American society, there's things that we reject in American society. You know, for example, I mean, the openness and going to and on higher education is wonderful here. Pornography, just like the internet, pornography is terrible, but the Torah study from the internet is great. I mean, think about how much Torah study we can do without living. So we see everything in kind of this gray area world that we live in. I mean, we're tolerant. Hasidim are not like that. Hasidim see the world black and white. You're either here or you're out there. I'm not talking about Chabad, because Chabad is a little different because of the ideology of reaching out to secular Jews, put us in the milieu of secular Judaism. And therefore, you know, we have to, by nature, if you want to succeed in this business, you have to learn A, tolerance. You know, you can't start saying, okay, you know what? You don't daven like I daven, so therefore you must be different. But Hasidim, who don't live in this, who are not interested in the secular Jewish community, see the world in black and white. The primacy of the world is the Torah. That's it. It starts there and it ends there. And everything is dictated by the Torah itself. So if the Torah says no college, no college. No internet. No television.
But where does the Torah say?
Oh, but you know, if you look in the Talmud and the whole idea of being built up and Hasidim throughout the ages, it has rejected secular life. I mean, through its fight against the Haskalah, I mean, the Enlightenment in Russia, where the fighters were the Hasidim and the Litvaks, were both fighting heavily. And this is not only true of the Hasidim, but it's also true of the yeshiva world. That the yeshiva world, like Lakewood, for example, will shun going to college because your life is study of Torah. That's it. Now you have to make a living, so you know, become a diamond cutter, become a bookkeeper, become, you know, a teacher, you know, something else. Or many choose, like in the movie we were talking about, Ushpizin, to sit and learn. Now there's one question that wasn't answered in that movie, and this parenthetically taking off, is what we were discussing last night. Now how does he get, what happens when the money runs out?
We were discussing that
right
tonight.
You see, he was relying on a miracle, but what happened after the money runs out? That they didn't discuss in the movie. Now maybe we'll discuss this a little while, but that leads Hasidim to see the world black and white. So therefore, if it's not in the Torah, it's gotta be against the Torah. And the internet is certainly not Torah worthy.
Okay, so
It has all of this schmutz on the internet, so that has to be shut. Computers, absolutely, it's not gonna, you know. Now, if you see the world in those terms, if you see everything is black and white, then to them, it's very simple, life is very simple. They try to live, although it's interesting, but if you go to it like a Satmar business, they'll have computers and they'll know how to set up a computer. So, you know, after you get married, then it's kind of permitted because you know what, it's you have to. Believe me, every business Satmar that they run, these huge camera places like 47th Street Photo and all of these huge companies, they have computers already. And all the guys who are running the computers are, but in their houses, no. And if you want to, for example, teach in a Satmar school, I'm not just picking on the Satmars because I think that they're probably the most right-wing and extreme, you know, of all. But if you go teach in a Satmar school, you have to sign that you have no television in your house, you won't allow a television in your house, and all of that things. I mean, I remember someone was telling me that they had started a school, it was kind of a Chabad slash Satmars who became Chabad, you know what I mean? It was one of these crossover schools. And so to Lubavitcher's, if you go into a Lubavitcher school, a Chabad school, you'll see computers there, there's a secular, some secular studies. So this school opened up and, you know, they set up the school with the receptionist in the front and a computer in the office. The parents walked in and they almost had a cow. How could you have a computer in the office? The kids are going to come in the morning, they're going to see a computer in the office, so they made them take the computer to the back room. They didn't want the kids to see the computer whatsoever. This is the ideology to try to protect the kids from outside influences. That is, they've always expressed themselves, and where does a potato grow best? Where? In the ground. So that's where we want to keep our kids, in the ground. That and you have this outlook. Now, what it lends to is one of two things. Either you're gonna have tremendously pious children who are gonna live, you grow up in here, and they're gonna, you know, follow your ways, and they're gonna, you know, do everything you want them to do, and they have faith and they really believe, and like Moshe prays, he needs money, he goes out there, Hashem, you know, he has perfect faith and she has perfect faith, and that's the way you're gonna, and they're gonna live, and they don't need computers, and they don't need anything else, and then they love each other, and that's it. Or you're gonna have rebellion on your hands. You're gonna have rebellion. And this happens among many Hasidic groups, that you have people that just can't take the stifling, because there's no way that it doesn't penetrate into the community. I mean, because you walk outside in New York City and Manhattan, there's hookers on the street. And you think to yourself, okay, Dad, what exactly are those? So he said, oh, that's a donkey. You know, don't worry, that's a donkey. Oh, you know, hey, you know, I'm such a donkey. How do I get a donkey? You know, and that's the way it goes. So you have rebellion. And I shouldn't say only among Satmar, but among all Orthodox. You know, whenever there's restrictions, there are going to be some kids who are not going to be able to take the restrictions and are going to leave. And are going to walk out. I remember seeing a story in the New York Times, maybe about a decade ago, or maybe less than a decade ago. There was a guy in the front cover of the New York Times, had a big tattoo on his stomach, like, you know, the gang tattoos, and it said Satmar on it. All right, it said Satmar on it, and the caption was Satmar's bad boys. And they had a whole group of guys living in Manhattan that had just left the community, and you were into drugs, into heavy metal, rock and roll, and, you know, living with non-Jewish girls. And these were guys that when they were interviewed said they just couldn't take it. They couldn't take the restrictions, and, you know, and they said to leave. Now, when they leave, you leave. I mean, it's not like, you know, like you're gonna come home for Friday night with the tattoos and the earrings and the nose ring to your house. I mean, this is totally unacceptable to them. So they won't, they leave and they forget about it. You know,
let's go to the top.
Yeah.
I know that the Lubavitcher Rebbe studied him at
university. Right. Yeah.
What about the other Rabbi?
Okay, so let's just take the Rebbe for example, because you bring up a good point. The Rebbe himself was very much against college. Now you might say to yourself, how could this fit into his whole persona? I mean, here the Rebbe was a modern guy who used computers and he advocated his Hasidim, you know, take all the technology and let's use it for Torah use. Okay, so how does a man like that, who went to college, dissuade his Hasidim from going to college? So in my family, when I was in high school, I mean, my parents, you know, wanted me to go to college. They thought they're going to get the doctor, you know, out of it. Okay, don't feel so bad for my mother. She has a son-in-law doctor, so it kind of worked out, you know, kind of worked out. And so I, you know, I always knew that I grew up in the Chabad yeshiva, always knew that the Rebbe's position was don't go to college. And all the rabbinical students that were in yeshiva at that time were always telling me, no, you can't go to college, you gotta go to yeshiva, Abba, you gotta go to yeshiva. And I said, but my parents want me to go to college. And then I asked this question. I said, why is everybody dissuading us and me and a number of friends not to go to college when the Rebbe himself went to college? Oh, so the answer was, let me tell you a story. It's always an answer given by parable. So I'm gonna give you a parable, okay? There were two brothers. And one of them was very wealthy and one of them was very poor. So the wealthy one went to visit the poor brother, and he saw it was a total shambles, you know. I mean, his house's roof was leaking, everything was bad. I mean, it was just terrible. The kids were wearing shabby clothes. It was just a very, very horrible scene. So he invited his brother to come visit him. Now he came to Beverly Hills. His brother was living in a nice mansion. Everything was and he showed him around the house, the bedrooms, the garden, the pool, everything beautiful there. At the end of his stay, the rich brother said, listen, you know, I really feel bad for you. And I saw your house and everything like that. I'm gonna give you $50,000 to get you on your feet. All right? This a brother, responsible for another brother, he writes him $50,000 and he gives it to him. Okay, the brother leaves, and 6 months later, the rich one was curious what his brother is up to. He didn't hear from him. So he travels to his brother, and he comes to the property, and it's the same. It looks exactly the same. I mean, the front porch is broken, and the house is unpainted, the paint is peeling. I mean, he looks at his nephews and nieces still wearing the same shabby clothes. So he walks and his brother comes out to greet him, and he says to him, listen, I'm a bit surprised at what did you do with the money? Well, you know, where's the money? So he says, let me show you. So he brings him to the back of the house. He has this gorgeous bathroom, an exact replica of what his brother had in his house. So he had this gorgeous, gorgeous bathroom. I mean, with the beautiful faucets and the 8 shower heads coming out and the big tub. So his brother says, well, what'd you do? He says, well, you know, I came into your house and I was so impressed with your bathroom that I decided with the $50,000, I'm gonna build myself a great bathroom. So the rich brother said, you know, you're a dummy. You're a dummy, boy. He says, when you have money in the bank, 401k plan, your children are well fed, well dressed, your car runs properly, everything in your house is spit and span, then you have extra money, you put it into the bathroom. That's the last of your needs. But to take the money that you so preciously have and put it into a bathroom, that's ridiculous. What's the analogy? So the analogy was, I'm the bathroom, and the Rebbe is the rich brother. Why is that? So they're said like this. The Rebbe, when he went to college, he was already well-versed. He wasn't a spring chicken, he was well in his 20s. He was already well-versed in all of the Talmud he knew by heart. He knew all of Hasidic philosophy. He knew all of the codifiers. He knew all of the questions and responses within Judaism. He was a tremendous scholar. So now to add, after his whole scholarship, to add a little bit of secular knowledge, okay, he went to college. You know nothing. So now you want to go and secular college was compared to the bathroom. So instead of going to yeshiva to build up your knowledge of Yiddishkeit and of spirituality and of Judaism, what are you going to do? You're going to go straight to college. So you're like the poor brother who's a dummkopf. Okay? So that was the answer always given to us. The Rebbe was different. He was really a great scholar, and you don't ask any questions on the Rebbe. Okay. So to make a long story short, I decided what I'm going to do is I'm going to appease both parties. What do you do? Parents, college, school, no college. I said like this, Ma, Pa, listen, I'm going to do this. Give me 1 year. I'm going to go to yeshiva. Go to Morristown, New Jersey. I'll study for 1 year. After that, I'll come home. I'll go to college. Everybody will be happy. I'll appease my friends in the yeshiva because, we want another soul. We got him to go to yeshiva. But then I'm going to come back. And I'm going to go to college. So I end up to yeshiva, and I remember clearly as today, there were five of us in the bus, because in those days, you know, we would travel by Greyhound bus from Montreal to Morristown, New Jersey. We'd go on bus all night, we'd come like little yokel bokels, you know, with our suitcases to the yeshiva, and we show up over there. So they suddenly throw us out. The first thing they said, your parents never made arrangements for you to come here, so we don't even know that you're registered over here. This was our welcome to Morristown. So okay, we got our fathers to register and all of that stuff, tuition thing. We come into the yeshiva, and you know what, I wasn't a culture shock, but now it was a much bigger, we were Montrealers, so Canadians were always looked at like coming, like country yokels, you know, where are you from? Canada, well, Canada, well, what's that? You know, straight up America, great America, you know, when summer camp, every year would be the same war. You know, we'd have a summer camp up in Montreal. A lot of New Yorkers would come to spend their summer there. And every summer would be a war. What's better, Canada or America? Canada or America? Canada or America? I mean, okay, fine. So that 1 year turned into 8 years. Because what happened was that we had such a teacher that he made Judaism live. Like, I said, this is Judaism. This couldn't be Judaism. Because for 12 years, we always had these teachers with the sticks, and they beat the... And they beat you up, you know. They beat you up. So I did. Whoever appreciated that. But this teacher made Judaism alive. I mean, he made the Talmud come alive. So I said to him, came back after the first year. I said, Mom, Pa, you know what? One more year. That's it. It's a 2 year program, Morristown. I'm telling you, Ma. Right afterwards, it's straight to McGill. Okay. What's he gonna argue with? Fine. One more year. At the end of the second year. I remember they came to me and they said, you know what, of my whole class, they chose 10 students to go on a special mission. They said, the Rebbe chose you to go. The Rebbe chose me to go on a special mission of the whole class, 10 guys. Well, how could you say no to the Rebbe himself? Huh? So I called up my father and my mother. I said, Ma, it's 2 more years, but I'm telling you, after that, it's definitely off the college. After 4 years, I think they began to realize that it ain't gonna happen. I mean, this is not gonna be the doctor that we always, another 4 years in rabbinical school, and that was it, finished. Yeah, and end of discussion. So to make a, like my specialty, to make a long story out of a short question is that that's what Hasidim's focus was on perpetuation of Yiddishkeit through the study of Torah, and don't allow any of the secular forces to intrude into our world. And I think this is a direct result from their war and their struggle in Eastern Europe, where they struggled against the Haskalah, the Enlightenment, and all of the secularism, the Reform movement was a big part. So when they came here, they built a wall around themselves, and they said, "Nah, this is where we're going to live, and all we can do is take from the outside world." I mean, you know, customers, we always like from the outside world, but to allow it to enter into our things. And that's why, that'll answer question number two. Why the Hasidim wear black hats, black coats, and fur hats? This is especially works into their world view, because you know what, we can't change. Just because we're here in America and people wear short coats and suits and, you know, no hats, forget about it. We're gonna live the same way we lived in Eastern Europe, in Poland and in Hungary and in Russia. And since those days, we kind of prided ourselves that the black coats, the kapotes as they were called, or the whatever you called it in your particular town, was worn by the gentry, you know, by the besserer mentioned, the finer people. We adopted that and even made its way over into the United States to show the world that we're not changing. That we are going to keep the same traditions we had back in Eastern Europe, because those were holy. Those were holy traditions. And the same thing with the fur coat. The Rebbe caused a revolution when he wore a fedora. I mean, when he put on a black hat with the brim down, it was like, oh my gosh, he is already going off the path. He is already, forget about it, he's already reformed. Reformed chassid to such a degree that even that, When the Rebbe came on a boat in 1941, and his father called in a few Hasidim, and he said, I want you to go pick up my son-in-law at the docks. And they said, how will we know who he is? How are we going to recognize him? So he said, here's a man that knows, and he began to enumerate all of his characteristics. He knows the Talmud Bayard, he knows this, he knows that, he knows this, this and that, that, and this and this and this, and he wears his brim down. And the Rebbe, who used to wear his hat, would put it down to show that he's kind of, you know, like a bit modern, you know, so to say, and everything like that. But this is a direct, I think, a direct cause of the battle that the Hasidim waged back then A, first against the Misnagdim themselves, meaning the battle of the between the early Hasidim and the Lithuanians, but later on when they figured out that they have a bigger enemy than each other, that's when all of this started, and this was their criteria, and it has absolutely nothing to do with Judaism. The coat and the black hat, I mean, have nothing to do with. There's nowhere in the Talmud or anywhere in the Chumash that it says you must wear a black hat and a long fur coat or a fur coat. A black coat and a fur hat, anywhere, but it became almost as important as if Moses himself wore it. And you know, I thought when I was a kid that Moses actually wore them. You know, whoever thought of him wearing one of these, like a tablecloth? Would he wear one of these things like the Arabs wear? That didn't make any sense to me. How could he do that? I'm sure Moses spoke Yiddish, and then he came, didn't come from, how could he come from Egypt? Are you crazy? Some of Moses coming from Egypt, such a great person, from Poland. His name was probably Moshe Rabinovich, something like that, you know, and all of that stuff. And this is what Jews look like. But then as you begin to get older, no, this is not what Jews look like. This is what Polish Gentiles looked like that Jews adopted, because we are chameleons. Right, we come into Poland and we wear Polish clothes, just like in the United States. We follow the trend of whatever everybody else is wearing. We're going to wear it. And I think that it's slowly but surely dawning upon us, not among Hasidim, but among the majority of Jews, that, and especially among modern Orthodox Jews, which is a growing segment within the Orthodox community, that, you know what, there are things that we can incorporate without really destroying and burning down the house, because Hasidim always said, if you bring a computer, might as well burn down your house. I mean, you're going to bring in influences that are going to destroy your family. You might as well smoke pot. I mean, for the same thing. Bring pot in, bring non-Jewish girls into your house, because that's what you're doing with a computer and a television. But the modern Orthodox world has a little bit different view. I mean, they say, hey, you know what? There are certain things in American society that you can bring in, incorporate into Judaism. It's not going to kill anybody. It's not, you know, going to college, YU, Yeshiva University, Stern College for Women, Touro College. My daughter graduated there. My oldest son goes, you know, to Touro College. It's a college just for men. You know, they go, they study. So it's kind of blends, you know, but they get a secular degree and you go on, some guys go on to medical school, guys on law school, you know, other schools. But, they've taken it and they've incorporated that. And they say, hey, you know what? We can live with this. And that segment within Orthodoxy is growing more and more as people begin to see that it's not just a black and white, either you're with us or you're not with us, but there are things within American society that we can adopt, and that we can do. And certainly, living here in California, they started now, Touro was opening up here in Los Angeles, and kids are even going to regular colleges, Hasidics are going, you know, my daughter goes to Fordham, which is a Catholic university, and it's hard for me to believe that this daughter, my daughter Goldie, who we never thought is going to get out of high school, is going for a master's degree at a Catholic college. But you know what? Miracles do happen, and we were just discussing it today. You know, me and her, and she was so proud. And, you know, she had passed two tough tests, you know, for her accreditation. And you know, and we're talking about how, you know, like in high school, she used to get credit because I worked at the academy, my wife works at the academy, that she got credit for working the front desk. She would answer the phone and say, "Hey, Goldie, you're getting credit for whatever, you know, give her an A in home ec, or whatever it was." And here she is today, you know, certainly I believe that if you're not going to be a rabbi, I mean, maybe my next son Moshe looks more like in the vein where he's going to follow in our footsteps and become a rabbi. My oldest son Yankee, I told him, listen, you know, if you're not going to go into yeshiva, you can't just hang around. You can't just get a job, because if you're going to get a job, what kind of job are you going to get? You'll be a schlepper. You want to work, you know, in someone's phone store, you know, on 13th Avenue. That's what they're going to take. They're going to pay you minimum wage. You got to get today. You have to make a living. And I'm back to two generations ago, where I'm forcing them, whether you like it or not, you got to go out there and get. But I think that he'll appreciate it better, maybe not today, but you know, when he's able to afford. Because I told him, listen, you want to send your kids to Jewish day school like you went to? So you're not going to get the breaks that I got because I'm a rabbi. You're not going to work in a school like me. Mommy worked in a school, job here, job there, to put you through yeshiva. You want to send your kids to day school? It's $10,000 per kid per year.
That's right.
Who can afford that? 10,000. So if you have five kids, and Hasidim have a lot of kids, you think about $10,000 every year per kid. And that's not talking about later on, post the high school, but now. So you have to be able to make a good living. And how many entrepreneurs are there? And not that many in reality. My son, who goes to college in New York, during the day he has a full-time job at a company that a 23-year-old Chassid owns. I mean, he's a 23-year-old guy, started a company at 17. Now he's a born entrepreneur. Okay, he's a born entrepreneur, he's a millionaire right now at 23. He employs 40 people, it's a nice sized company, and my son works there on the computer, doing that stuff. But how many guys are like that? One in 1,000, one in 10,000 are gonna be like that. But you have to be able to do that.
Back up a little bit.
Okay.
The Hasidim don't want to let in the outside world.
Correct.
Because it could be corrupting and...
Exactly.
The big battle between the Hasidim and the Miznagdim related to prayer versus study, in essence. But the Miznagdim, they were Torah scholars. They didn't want to let in the outside world either.
Of course, absolutely.
So,
absolutely.
Where did that?
But I'm saying, the Miznagdim are the same way today.
Yeah. The Miznagdim
are what we call the Litvaks. Lithuanians. Okay. Yeah. The Lithuanians. So if you go to New York, if you want to know the boundaries, basically, but no, just roughly, we spent some time in New York. Borough Park is Hasidim. Flatbush would be the Miznagdim, would be more the Litvisha yeshiva types. But even they are against college. Even they are vehemently against, not vehemently, but the reason why I speak about Hasidim, because they're much more visible. You see, the Litvaks don't wear regular suits, many of them shave, they look more, quote-unquote, normal. Hasidim are not. Hasidim wear the long, if you see someone with long payas, they're not Misnagdim. They're Hasidim. I mean, Misnagdim, even though they're against allowing secular society, but at least in their dress and their outside appearance, kind of look more normal. I would say.
Does the antipathy still exist in New
York? I think so. I think to a certain degree it still exists. I mean, I still think that the Miznagdim, the Litvaks, have taken this idea of Torah scholarship, much less than it was. Because in the olden days the battle was ferocious, and God forbid if someone married another family from one, either Litvaks, Lithuanians, or Hasidim, it would be over. I mean, there would be excommunication.
Don't come back. Galician.
Now, the Galicianer, forget about it. Until Hasidim penetrated big time in Galicia, then it became okay to marry a Galicianer, but Hasidim basically took over Galicia. I often talk about the Baal Shem Tov, just to give a perspective. I mean, the Baal Shem Tov came into the world, or at least started to preach and minister in the year 1736, and when he was about 36, 35, 36 years old. In 2 years, they claim he had 2,000 Hasidim. He was able to gather among him, his followers about 2,000. By the time he died in 1760, which was 23 years later, he had over 200,000 Hasidim. I mean, basically Hasidim swept the board in Eastern Europe. I mean, they were so ferocious, I mean, they were such marketers, I mean, and they were tired, and he himself was a tireless traveler. He went from town to town to town to town to town, and then pick up this guy, pick up that guy, and once the rabbi fell, the town fell. I mean, that's all you had to do. You had to convince the rabbi to become a chassid. We're gonna stop davening the Nusach Ashkenaz and now adopt Nusach Ari. That was it. So the town said, if the rabbi is going, what do we know? And that's how it went. So Galicia was a stronghold, a huge stronghold. I mean, Belz comes out of Galicia, Bobov comes out of Galicia. I mean, some of them, not us, not where I come from. I mean, I come from Poland, real Poland, like Lodz, where my mother was, Ger all the way. Ger Hasidim, and if you married someone out of the Ger, forget about marrying a Misnagdim. I mean, that was unheard of. Who would marry a Litvak in Poland? I mean, forget about that. But even if you married outside of the Ger Hasidic group, my mother had, I think, 80 first cousins among all of her siblings, 80 first cousins. I think everyone married a Ger. She said she couldn't remember not having a Ger cousin. Her grandparents, both of my great grandfathers, fire and brimstone, and you know, Hitler just kind of basically wiped this whole thing. So I think after the war, you know, once Mesnagdim and Hasidim began to see, you know, we're all going into ovens together, because Lithuania was devastated. I mean, the Nazis just completely cleared out Jewry out of Lithuania, and what they destroyed there. I mean, it's just a crime. I mean, you know, what they destroyed over there.
Percentage-wise, there were more Jews killed in Lithuania than in any other.
That's right. That's right. I mean, it was just devastating for Lithuanian Jews. So we began to think to ourselves, hold on a second, you know, it's pretty good. I think it's smarter that maybe we should bend together, but still, you know how it is. It's tribal. I mean, if I belong to a Chabad movement, my children, I want them to marry Chabadniks. Why? Would I be devastated if my son found this Litvish girl and married her? Of course not, I wouldn't be devastated, but his whole upbringing, his whole, everything is Chabad, his customs are Chabad. You know, we've talked about the Rebbe, his allegiances to the Rebbe. So it just leads to tribalism, and that's basically what we're breeding. We're breeding Chabad, breeds more Chabad, and that's how it works. So I think that empathy, it might still be there, but not as strong. I mean, we're not as passionate about anything anymore as we used to be in the old days, but still, this whole idea of not allowing secular world is true for both. I mean, that's why they built a yeshiva in Lakewood, New Jersey. Why go to Lakewood, New Jersey? Why would Aaron Kotler go to Lakewood, New Jersey? Because he figured being in a big suburban city would not lend to Torah scholarship, because you're always going to be distracted by something. You know, there's movie theaters,
who built it?
His name was Rabbi Aaron Kotler.
Kotler,
yeah. which was mentioned prominently in that book. So he moved to Lakewood and built probably the biggest Litvisha yeshiva in the United States, probably maybe even in the world. It's a little bit, so just a little bit south of Morristown is Lakewood, and it's a huge, huge Litvisha place, but there's many Hasidim send their children there, not Chabad. Chabad has their own yeshivas, but many other Hasidim send their sons, to study over there. But his idea was to go out to the pastures. What was Lakewood in the 50s? Was farmland. And he thought, this is the perfect idyllic setting. There's nothing that's going to disturb us. Here's where we can build Jerusalem all over again. And it was kind of, right. Other great rabbis built inside suburban areas. Cleveland, for example, has a big Tel Yeshiva. Baltimore has a big Ner Yisrael Yeshiva. Toronto has a big Ner. But he himself felt, because of this idea of influence into the movement itself, that kids going to walk down the street in New York, just by walking down the street already, it's going to be problems. There's going to be problems. And that's, you know, for better or for worse, I'm not here to, there's no judgment. The judgment here, I'm not saying it's good or bad. Obviously, since I'm a chassid, I mean, rah, 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 you know, all the more power to them, you know, whatever they do. But that's the ideology of what's behind this whole idea of garb and living together in a little community, separated by walls. I mean, you know, we live, when I say we, I'm saying Chabad headquarters is in Crown Heights. I mean, me and Bob went there, you know, last year. We saw in Crown Heights, you basically have two types of people living there. They either Chabadniks or African Americans. That's all that lives in Crown Heights. And I tell you, if I tell you that the interaction between the Hasidim and the African Americans are none, then I'm exaggerating too much already. I'm already saying there's too much interaction. When I say there's no interaction, a good morning to the neighbors probably is as much as you're gonna get between the two groups. And we're living not side by side. Not only side by side, you have one group here and one group there, but integrated in the same street. You have Chabad, black, and there's absolutely no communication between the two groups, because this is these are African Americans. These are not Jews, and they're not Jews, and they're not even secular Jews. They're African Americans.
What if they were Falasha?
Oh, then it would be a different story. Then we'd invite them to our sukkah. You would do all of that stuff, you know. So Hasidim are not big into Tikkun Olam. You know, the reform words of how to repair the world, ecumenical seders invite, you know, the reverends from the Episcopalian Church, the Methodist Church, come and let's celebrate Passover together, and you know, we'll have, no, Chabad, no Hasidim were like that. I mean,
okay, you first brought something that I
is it halachically incorrect or whatever to invite a Gentile to a Seder?
Oh, that's a very good question. That is a very, very good question.
I have been
question.
Told. I
yes.
used to invite.
Yes. Yes.
And yeah. My daughter and son-in-law are Orthodox. And my son-in-law said, no, because you cannot talk about destruction, about killing people, while you have maybe their descendant in your home.
That's, yeah, he's halachically he's right, but wrong reason.
Okay.
It's the wrong reason. The reason is it's you know, to us who live in such a secular world and not, and such a tolerant world would think, God, how can you even say? But the law is that on Pesach you're only allowed to cook for Jews. Okay, so you not only Pesach but on Yom Tov, you're allowed to cook, but the cooking has to be done for Jews. Okay? Now what's going to happen if you say to yourself, okay, you know what, I'm going to invite a Gentile to come to the Seder. Oh, I'm going to throw in an extra piece of meat in the cholent. Oh, prohibited. You can't do that. You can't do that because now you're cooking for a Gentile. So that's why there was a prohibition about inviting Gentiles to the Seder. Now, so on one hand, he's absolutely correct. You know, on the other hand, when you're living in a world where there are hardly any Gentiles, so this is an irrelevant old question. Who's going to invite a Gentile anyways to the Seder? If you ask a typical Jew living in Lodz, are you going to invite a Polak to the Seder? What do you mean? Well, why not invite the Pope to the Seder? I mean, the same offer. Why in the world would I invite a Polak to the Seder? Why would I invite a German to the Seder? It was completely unheard of. Here in America, you know, it's a little bit different, right? I mean, because, you know, your son-in-law's parents might be Italian. You know, I mean, intermarriage does happen. So, you know, I mean, not in the case of where your daughter and son-in-law go, Baruch Hashem, thank God they're Orthodox, but it's quite likely 50% chance that your in-laws are Italian. Now, what are you going to do? You're not going to have to have them. So, now we're going to get, this is a subject that's really, you're walking a fine line. But I remember one time I was at Beth David, they invited me to do like a panel discussion. I'm representing the Orthodox community. Like if the Orthodox rabbis would know that I'm representing them, they would convert immediately. I mean, like I'm like the worst representative of Orthodoxy. But I, quote unquote, I'm representing Orthodox, that Reform, Conservative, and Reconstructionist. Fine. We sit down, we start schmoozing. I give my little cute little lines because I'm deflecting every question because I could be the only loser. I mean, who else can lose? What Reform is, he's home court advantage. No one understands what Reconstructionist is, so he doesn't have to worry about anything. He spoke some stuff now, whoa, no one understood what's going on over there. And Conservative always has schizophrenics, it jumps here, it jumps. The only loser could happen is me. I could be the big loser because they're going to paint me in a corner to say, look at fanaticism, fundamentalist, you know, I'm like Pat Robertson, you know, so I tried my best to show that I am completely not Orthodox. You know, I tell them I eat at the In-N-Out Burger every Thursday night. You know, I'm doing everything I possibly can to dispel any idiosyncrasies or any preconceived notions or stereotypes of what Orthodoxy is. But not, of course, I'm being facetious about the In-N-Out Burger, okay?
Whatever.
So I ate there once, one time, and it's like, no, I'm joking. I never ate there, God forbid. But you know what? So here, so I'm trying to be coy and cute and throwing a few jokes out there and everything. The discussion finishes, and I thought that, you know what, I held my own, you know, I gave reasonable answers to the tough questions, especially women. How could you win on any women's questions? There's no way you could win on women's questions. There's no way you could win on any social action questions, because, you know, anything like that. So I thought, you know, with the women, we hold women in a higher esteem, and that's why you don't have to come to shul, because they can rest while we have to go. And, you know, I was tap dancing along all night, and I thought to myself, oh, you know what, I thought I did a credible job, you know, at least defending Orthodox, that I didn't come across as some Satmar fanatic that's out to, you know, burn down, you know, this temple, now I'm sat in the sanctuary. Okay, everybody's invited downstairs for cookies and coffee. And then the rabbis could come downstairs and then you could personally attack them. If you didn't attack them publicly in the room, you could come down and then personally attack them. Okay, so I'm sitting down there and I'm getting a drink and this, you know, right away, a group of it. And one lady says, I want to tell you something, Rabbi. I see it coming already. You know, she's pointing the finger. Orthodoxy has, you came to say that orthodoxy brings people together. Orthodoxy destroyed my family. Well, orthodoxy destroyed your family. My son became Orthodox. That was it. He won't come. So she has in her family one Orthodox son, one son that married out. Okay? Forget about the son that married out. Let's even say he married in, but he's reformed. So he now has a bat mitzvah of his daughter. So the son, the Orthodox son, will fly to California but won't come to the temple. So he'll come to every other party except going to the temple, because you can't join in services there. It's Reform services. Orthodox will not join in Reform services. So what did Orthodoxy do for me, Rabbi? So I said, so this question really, I mean, you're putting me really up against the wall, because you're not talking theoretically. If you say, you know what, Reform is so much better than Orthodoxy because we could do mixed dancing, okay, I can argue with you, man. If you saw my wife, you wouldn't want to mix dance. Let's say, you know, something like that or something. Or, you know, yes, I don't, forget about it. Whatever it is, you can show something, you know, funny. But here, she's not talking theory, and she's not talking theology. She's hurting, and you know, and her son who became Orthodox is now literally breaking her family apart. So I said, you know what? Listen, there's two parts of this question, I believe. Part one is that your son has to lighten up a bit. Your son has to lighten up a bit. You know what? That which he can't do, he can't do. Okay, I cannot blame him for not going to Reform services, because I wouldn't go to the Reform services, to be honest. But you have to lighten up, even the way you say it, because I know the guy. I've met this guy subsequently, and he is a, I know this could be edited, hard ass. That's what he is, right? He's a hard ass. You know what? He will not give an inch. So no matter what, so even when he comes home, he makes it hard for his brother to visit on Shabbos. Why is he driving on Shabbos? I mean, even things that are not have to do with the temple. So he's just a tough cookie to start off with. So he has to lighten up. He's got to buy a few Seinfeld tapes, you know, like, you know, watch Curb Your Enthusiasm on HBO. You know, just lighten up a little bit. Life is not that dour. But what happens is, and parenthetically, he became a Litvak. I mean, not, he was not a Baal Teshuva through Chabad. He became one of these hardcore Litvak, you know, studying yeshiva every day and, you know, and all this, and, you know.
And why are you looking at me?
I don't know why. I'm looking at the camera. Then, second, you have to understand also, you know what, tolerance works two ways. It's a two-way street, you know, and the fact that he did not go to the Reform service, and I know your son was very upset, you know, in there, and it hurt him terribly, has to understand that this is not a decision that he came by easily. It certainly wouldn't be for me, that, you know, in certain cases, it wouldn't be, but there are certain principles, everybody has their principles, you know, that we have to know, and your other son has to also lighten up a little bit, to say, you know what, if I really cared about his brother, I would make it kosher. I would make you know, some kind of concessions to appease this other brother. So both of them, you know, are very rigid in their positions. He's not going to change, but who comes out looking bad? The Orthodox. Because here he is, you know, representing the Torah, and he won't come into a shul which is filled with Jewish people. So he becomes looking. So it's a very complicated and a hurtful question. Why? How did this come to it? Because we're talking about, you know, Pesach. So now on Pesach, really, strict halachically, okay, let's say for whatever reason was your daughter-in-law did not convert, and I don't mean your daughter-in-law, but I'm just saying, yeah, a daughter-in-law did not convert. Okay, so here's our choices. A, you don't have your family to the Seder, because you can't have her to the Seder. She's not Jewish. So what are you gonna call up? Okay, you know, you're gonna say, hey, Jackie, I'd like you to come to the Seder, but hey, Christy and the kids stay home. Oh, that's gonna work, yeah, right? That's really gonna work, you know? So you have to have her over at the Seder. Now, to me, there's no question in my mind what the answer to me would be. I mean, even though in my own family, that's not happening, but in reality, it happens there all the time. So I would say you have your daughter-in-law over and your grandchildren, because ultimately, You know what, you have to weigh what is going to cause more pain. And if you're sitting at the Seder and you're eating the matzah and the mor, and you don't even have to eat the mor to feel bitter, because you're already bitter because your son is, you know, is living in Pacoima and he's not going to the Seder, so what's better? You know, so to me, there are certain issues where halakhically, yes, you know, correct, but I don't see it. Now, is it a mitzvah to invite your Gentile ophthalmologist? That's already, who has no connection to you, but you want to be nice to him and have him. Then already I would be a little bit more conservative in my answer. There I would say, listen, if you're really trying, if you're not Orthodox, no one asks anyways. You know, who cares about what the Orthodox position is? But if you're Orthodox and you would come to me and you say, listen, you know, I want to know, I'm making a Seder, I'd say, do you, tonight you have to invite him? How about inviting him next Friday night, or, you know, another time? Why does it have to be at the Seder itself? But if you, but you know, if you're committed, I'd say this is from those smaller sins in the world that we do.
Yeah.
You know, inviting people. But this issue, this one issue, is a tremendously divisive issue. Very, very, very difficult issue.
I can see why, because in the past we have invited Gentile friends.
Right.
We are not, we do not have mixed marriage.
Yeah.
But if, God forbid, my son would marry a Gentile.
Right.
Then, you know, and she would not marry. How could we not?
You know, you're inviting, what happens is, the problem is that from the book itself, from what it says in the book to how we live practically, is a very, very long, is a long road. I mean, because in the book, it makes all the sense in the world. All of Shulchan Aruch is perfect. There's no problems until you actually have to live it. Until you actually have to implement it in your own personal life. So therefore, you know what? My sister, as I mentioned to you before, was not Orthodox. She rebelled early on, goodbye. But my sister got married. We wanted to have her over for a Friday night meal. And we lived in a little ghetto within Montreal. So my father, God bless his soul, was still from the old country, always felt uncomfortable because she drove up and the neighbors, you know, looked out the window, and then would come my sister, you know, with her boyfriend, you know. So at that time, when he told her, listen, do me a favor, park around the, why do you have to park in front of the house? Park on the side of the road and walk to the house so people, okay. So in my mind, I said to him, this is crazy, but understanding where he came from and the image into the community, okay, fine, he worried about me, I wouldn't get such a good shidduch because they'll talk about his sister, so they had an age, you know, but you know what, forget about that. But that was issues that were going on, and it's still true today. Now, my father, you know, not excluding my parents and the milieu that we came from, there are many people today that are Bali Tshuva, that are people who return to the Orthodox fold without growing up Orthodox. Many of them study the book, and like the movie last night, he was a Bali Tshuva, take it seriously. I mean, this is what it says, this is how we have to do it. And what do you mean compromising? I mean, we gave up cheeseburgers for this life. We gave up, you know, going to clubs on Friday night for this life. And you're telling me, well, there's gray areas. What do you mean? Why didn't you tell me this before? I would have picked my own gray area to choose from. But no, they come into Judaism just like I would consider them like converts. Not exactly converts, but I love converts. I encourage as many converts to come into Judaism as possible for two reasons. One, because we need as many Jews as we can possibly get. I mean, there's nothing to talk about. B, they bring a whole new vitality to Judaism. When a real convert converts, I'm not talking about one where, you know what, the father-in-law is paying him off because, you know, he wants to feel good in his shul that his son-in-law converted. I'm not talking about that money conversion. But I'm talking about someone who's serious in their guts, wants to convert. They bring a whole new vitality into Judaism. There's life to Judaism. Jews who were born Jews come to Friday night services. Nah, you know, some are enthusiastic, some are not. You know, it's same old, same old. A convert loves this. It's like, you know, oh, wow, this is the greatest thing. So I think that's very important for us to have a dream. We need an injection, an infusion of this enthusiasm. Okay? But to them, it's black and white. This is what it says, Rabbi, you told me that I got to convert, and I live by the Shulchan Aruch, and I live by the code of Jewish law. And look, open up to this page, and it says, thou shalt not invite a Gentile on Pesach. What could he say? I mean, there's no arguing with them.
Why is that prohibited?
Because we talked about, because there's a prohibition of cooking specifically for Gentiles. You're allowed to cook on the holiday, but the holiday is, it's restrictive. On Shabbos, you can't cook. You're not allowed to cook. On the holiday, the Torah allowed you to cook, but only allowed to cook for your family. Family's extended now to the Jewish family. So therefore, it excludes cooking for a Gentile. You can't specifically cook for a Gentile on Yom Tov. So we're worried. So like we said before, if you invite 10 people and there's two Gentiles, so instead of making two rolls of gefilte fish, you'll make three rolls of gefilte fish. Oh, you know. So that's why. So that's so these are questions that come up, when, and it takes a little while for that fire and brimstone to calm down a little bit, and then, and take it easy and relax, because you know what? The world will continue if you do invite your Gentile in-laws. I promise you that the world is not going to disintegrate. You just have to know, you've got to massage it. But to someone that's new to it, like, I can imagine if I would convert today to Catholicism, I would be a better Catholic than the Pope. I would today be such a Catholic. I'd be saying the rosary every day. I'd be running to Mass every morning. I'd be taking the Eucharist. I'd be on those knees every day praying to the Mother Mary. I would do everything because I found it. This is the greatest thing. And Yiddish can't, fesh, meh. I put on tefillin in the morning. Yeah, put on, dish put on. Yeah, put on, mumble the words, take it off. Then I remember, did I daven this morning? I think I went to shul. I don't remember it, but it happened like in a flash, in a blur. Because why? Because it's so rote, it becomes boring. It becomes boring, it becomes meaningless. If it becomes meaningless, you do it because, you know why? Because you just like you put on pants. That's the problem with Orthodoxy, is that it becomes FFBs, I should say. Not Orthodoxy, but FFBs, which are from birth. FFBs are from religious from birth. Like me, I'm an FFB, I have a tattoo on my arm, FFB. If I ever should faint, they should know that I'm not a Baal Tshuva, that I'm an FFB, and why? Because I've been doing this since 13 years old. Every single day, putting on tefillin, it's not the same today like it was. I mean, the first time I put on tefillin, the smell of the leather was beautiful. I mean, I remember the smell, the crackling of the tefillin coming off. My father, so proud, Holocaust survivor, never believed that he would see his son putting on tefillin, rolling up that white shirt, him helping me with the knot, the crack hard, because the leather is still worn hard, and the first time, and the cameras, and the tears flowing, Yeah, that lasted about 3 weeks. And after that, it was, do we have to do it today? But that's what it is. To add to what you were saying, that the whole idea, if you think about this, and as Americans, this would be wild to us, but the whole idea of the mitzvahs was separation. Yeah. I mean, think about it. God gave us the laws of kashrut to separate us from the Gentiles, to make sure that, Friday night, you're not over at O'Malley's, down on 2nd Street, you're dancing with O'Malley's. You're at home in shul, davening, you can't eat pork, you can't eat this, you can't eat that, so you can't go to their house, and that's the whole idea.
It goes for the FFBs.
Right. This is so here, to us, it's hard, but it's second nature. I mean, it's second nature. Get into your car, drive up to Pico Robertson, and do your shopping, go out to eat, and all of that stuff. But that's what the whole idea is. But and that's the realities of life. Is to do that. But when you do discover that and you live it, then you feel in your heart that it's all worth it because you have found the truth, right? You have found the truth.
Will a very observant Jew invite a reformed Jew into his home?
Oh, that's a very good question. That's a very good question. Generally, I'll tell you, my daughters who grew up here in California, go to New York for seminary. They go to teach a seminary in New York. So I have cousins who are Hasidim, not Chabad, but other Hasidim. They get invited to their house on Sukkot. So on Sukkot, they're sitting there and eating, and the lulav and esrog is there, and my daughter tells her, the cousin, and this is not my cousin, this is my cousin's children, who are Hasidim straight through. On Sukkot, one of the things that we do is we take the lulav and the esrog, we go out, we find other Jews, we try to get them to make a bracha on lulav and esrog. And she says to them, no, this can't be true. My daughter said, what are you talking about? We do this all the time. All over the world, there are today Hasidim walking up and down the streets. you know, looking for other Jews. And she says, you will let another Jew handle your lulav and your esrog if he's not a Sabbath observer, he's not a this. And my daughter, who grew up here in California, never encountered such an attitude. I mean, she grew up here in this shul. She said, what? She said, well, I wouldn't let a non-religious Jew take our lulav and esrog. Doesn't know what it's all about and everything like that. So that does that answer your question? I think that this pretty much wraps up what their idea is. Forget about this little thing. I mean, the big global thing. I remember in 67, the Rebbe came out with Mifsa Tefillin, talking about Tefillin, came out with a Tefillin campaign that everybody should put on Tefillin. Mm-hmm. Get every man to put on Tefillin. 10 yad, that was the name of the campaign. Just give us your hand, right? Put on Tefillin, and the Rebbe promised that this is going to be a Yeshua, this is going to be a salvation for the state of Israel. Okay? The Satmar Rebbe publicly wrote an open letter against this campaign, and he put a nine point, I don't want to equate it, but it was like Martin Buber's 95 arguments that he applied to the church, you know, in Germany. So he put out a 9-point complaint against the Rebbe's Mifsa Tefillin. A, how could
not
he,
Martin Buber?
Did I say Buber? I meant Martin Luther. Why did I say Buber? Martin Luther, of course. So here, 9-point campaign arguments. One, how could you put on tefillin with a guy that didn't wash Negelwasser in the morning? B, how could you put on tefillin with a guy that just came out of a movie theater on 42nd Street, a porno shop? B, how? A, three, it doesn't help anyways if he puts on tefillin because later on he's going to take off his yarmulke. So the whole mitzvah tefillin, you have to have, you have to be clean, your body has to be pure, and you have to have pure thoughts, and how could you put on tefillin? Okay? This was a Satmar Rebbe publicly challenging the Rebbe. I mean, this was not, you know, my daughter and the cousin having a little debate in an apartment at Border Park. So in the back, I have the book at home, in the back of volume 6 of the Rebbe's talks, and I still remember because we kept studying it over and over in Yeshiva, the Rebbe writes a 15-page rebuttal against him. I mean, on every single point. The bottom line is, the Rebbe says, A, if you get a Jew to put on tefillin, no one knows what kind of ramification that is in the world. How can you say anything about what the mitzvah is of a Jew, and you could save a person? There's a concept of a karkafta deloimonach tefillin. It's a person that never put on tefillin in his life. A karkafta is a head deloimonach tefillin. And there's a story in the Talmud that one rabbi put tefillin on, and this tefillin saved the guy from going to hell. You know, or whatever the case was, that tefillin, he literally grabbed him by his hair and he pulled him out because he once put on tefillin on this guy's head. He literally saved him from Gehenna, it's called, you know, purgatory. So the Rebbe said, you're going to sit here in New York and you're going to... But they were, throughout their entire careers, they were debating this whole ideology, where the Rebbe was going out there and reaching out to people, and his ideology was to exclude everybody else. I mean, this, either you're with the Torah or you're against the Torah. There's no compromise. They didn't compromise against Zionism either. I mean, if you think today, in my wildest imagination, I'm a Holocaust survivor's kid, that someone could stand up and publicly criticize, not even criticize Israel, just deny the very existence of the state of Israel. Deny the existence of the state of Israel after we've gone through in the Holocaust was to me unbelievable. But yet he published a whole book, Al Gula V'Al Tamur, the Satmar Rebbe. I have it somewhere in my house, I think it's hanging around somewhere. A whole book on his philosophy against Zionism, why he's against Zionism. And when Entebbe came, when the Rebbe publicly allotted the Israeli soldiers for the rescue on Entebbe, he publicly put ads in the newspapers saying, you know what, this was a desecration of the Sabbath, how could you call this a miracle? I mean, of course, challenging the Rebbe publicly, how could you call this a miracle? A, this was done on the Sabbath. B, this was done by non-Sabbath observers. C, this was no miracle. So the Rebbe said, you know what, it's a funny thing, but last week when he was in the hospital and he needed doctors to operate on him on Sabbath, he didn't have any of these worries. He didn't ask if the doctor is a Shomer Shabbos, if the nurse is a Shomer Shabbos, if whether they can operate on the Sabbath. He didn't worry about that when he is in the hospital. But here he's worried about whether it is. It's a different, completely world outlook. That's why I'm standing here. You don't have a Satmar standing over here because, you know, and to me, it's just,
Well, Satmar wouldn't talk to us.
Oh, they will talk to you if they can sell you a diamond or something
no,
like
no,
that.
Man, yeah,
yeah, yeah, I mean, yeah. If they can get it. But what would they talk to you about? What is there to talk about? They don't follow football. They're not going to say that you're not Jewish. Satmar wouldn't say you're not Jewish. And probably if you had the temerity to go into a Satmar shul, let's say if you went up to Williamsburg, you know what, I'm gonna go into the Satmar shul on a Friday night to service, they would probably treat you very nicely. They would invite you to their house. They're not cruel people, they're not animals. But in their minds, the reform movement is out. I mean, they've basically written them off. What go and deal, start dealing with reform Jews? For what purpose? What? What do you mean?
They're
Why? We're here. We don't run anybody out. We try to save whatever.
You try to save them.
Not save them. We don't talk about. But we're talking about writing them out of Judaism completely. I mean, I might have differences in Reform theology, but I don't have any problem with a Reform Jew, and certainly I want to reach that Reform. You know, do whatever we can. I mean, you know, to enhance and I think that the proof in the pudding is. The proof in the pudding is I think that reform is slowly inching back a little bit more towards more, I wouldn't call it orthodoxy, and I wouldn't even call it conservatism, but more towards ritualism, more rituals within the reform movement, because that's, and I think that's part and parcel of the whole Baal Teshuva movement. They see the whole movement is moving this way, and a lot of Baal Teshuvas come from where? Not from the Orthodox movement. They come from reform, so they see that more people want this, and I think that's something that we were able. No, I'm not saying me personally, but I think the movement pushed them, into this. But as far as the Satmars are concerned, Judaism begins and ends in Williamsburg. That's all that matters. Everything else that goes on around the world doesn't affect them whatsoever. They don't need it. They don't care for it. They're not interested. Women, they can ordain women. They can ordain gays. They can ordain. This is only proof to them. Every time the reform movement takes another step like this, just proves that we're right. That these are not legitimate movements within Judaism, and there's nothing to talk about. Who cares about them? No one needs them. No one cares about them. We're not interested. We'll do business with them, but that's we'll do business with anybody. But as far as interaction is, it's a no-no. It's nothing. It's yeah, that's the way it goes. There's always been a follow. Same thing, conservative. But reform is a better example because reform has moved more to the left. I mean, but conservative, same way. If you're not Orthodox, you're not Orthodox. There's nothing in common to talk about.
Would they acknowledge that a conservative is a Jew?
Oh, they'll acknowledge reform is also a Jew. They're not going to say you're not a Jew, even though they'll claim this can ye. No, they'll say it, but it doesn't. They don't really believe that. They believe that you're probably a Jew because ultimately, if you had decided to become a Satmar, they would accept you. They're not going to make you go through a conversion to become a Satmar. But in their minds, there's absolutely no common ground for us to talk about. There's nothing for me to talk about with you. You've chosen your path. You're going to wherever you're going, and I'm going my way, and that's it. That's the way it's going to be. There's no dialogue. What's a dialogue? What are you trying to prove to me that there's legitimacy within reform?
They don't vote.
Oh, they vote. Oh, do they vote? They vote big times. They vote big time because it's in their best interest.
And they vote the way the rabbi
says. Of course, they vote. They know how to vote because first of all, they need yeshivas. They need tax exempt. I mean, they need the government, like anybody else needs the government.
So they let the outside world in when it's to their benefit.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. They know how to work the systems. They really know how to work the systems. I mean, because that's a matter of survival. That's not a matter of compromise. But they did this in Europe too. When it was good to be good to the pirates, they paid the pirates off. When it wasn't good to be good to the pirates, they back off. So I mean, they know how to work the system. I mean, certainly in America, where Kiryas Yoel, their enclave up in the mountains in the Catskills, was the only place in the United States which got their own school system. They got their schools to be allocated or to be considered and as a legitimate public school system. Now, what does that help? That helps you get on, because if you're not a public school system, you don't get any of, they have special needs children, you need help. They have, buses, you need help. You know, food, you need help. And then that's, but New York is different. New York is a different state than the rest of this country. For example, here in California, just to give you an example, here in California, the public school budget is about $3 billion get spent on public schools here in California. And private schools get about $300,000 from the government. $3 billion to $300,000. So here, like for example, the Hebrew Academy gets no help whatsoever. But in New York, all the yeshivas get buses from public schools. They get lunch programs. New York is a different, but the Sacramento's no. Oh boy, you want to run in Williamsburg as their congressman. I remember Congressman Richmond. He won for many years. He was in their pocket. That means if there was a program in Washington and it benefited them, you bet that Richmond would be on that program and they'd be in his office and they voted as, you're voting as a block. And there's about 100,000 of them, they know how to do. They know how to punch Richmond. That much English they can read.
Modern Orthodoxy, is that an American phenomenon?
That's an American phenomenon, but it's really based upon a sect of Judaism within Germany. The father of modern Orthodoxy, Shamshon Raphael Hirsch, great guy. I love this guy. I love Shamshon Raphael Hirsch. I mean, I quote him all the time. Saturday mornings, we in our Torah study, I often quote him without giving him credit. I should give him credit. But he was the father of modern Orthodoxy. Now, how did this come about? It's an interesting story. He was an Orthodox rabbi, obviously, living in Germany. He was born, I believe, in 1800 and passed away in 1880. So he lived really at the time when Reform was just formulating within Germany and took off. So as an Orthodox rabbi, he saw the vast movement of Jews from Orthodoxy to Reform. Now, in Germany, unlike Eastern Europe or Poland and Russia, the Jewish communities and just in general, society was completely disorganized. I mean, the Russians couldn't get their act together, neither could the Polish get their act together, but in Germany, everything was organized. The Jewish community had to be organized. Now, money to build a yeshiva was given by the government. The government paid the Jewish community. How much do you need? You need one yeshiva, one mikveh, a shul, maybe two shuls, and it gave to the whoever ran the community. So it was always the Orthodox. When Reform came about, Reform started to usurp the power from Orthodoxy and began to take control of the community. So he decided, there's no secret about Orthodox battle with Reform. Reform had one ideology, Orthodoxy had a different battle. He writes in his magnum opus called the Chorev, he wrote a book called the Chorev, that he had a dream one night, that he woke up and there was a great conflagration, there was a fire burning. And he's like running, and he sees in the distance the fire, and something is literally urging him to run towards the fire. And he's running, and he sees from a distance, it's the temple. It's the holy temple. And so, he's running, and all of a sudden, as he gets closer to the fire, there's a person standing there, and in his mind, it was Moshe Rabbeinu. And Moshe Rabbeinu says to him, "Hey, where were you till now? The Beis HaMikdash is burning now. Now you come running after it's already finished." So to him, he took this as a sign that he needs to do battle against Reform. This is going to be his mission, that he's going to battle the Reformers. Okay, so how do you battle the Reformers? So there was a number of different rabbis throughout Europe that took different positions. Not so much in Eastern Europe, but among the Hasidim and the Litvisha, because they didn't penetrate into Poland and Russia, Reform. But other movements penetrated into there, but mostly in Hungary and in Germany. These two countries. So in Hungary, the chief rabbi was the Chassam Sofer, who basically excommunicated them. That was it. Chodesh Osir Min HaTorah. He said everything that Reform does is prohibited no matter what they do. It's prohibited. They built a wall around Reform, and they didn't allow. He fought them by not having to deal with them. Shamshon Raphael Hirsch said, "Listen, if I'm in Germany and I got to battle these guys, and what really did Reform do? Reform tried to bring in what we call progress. That was their key word: progress within Judaism. I mean, we got to go to universities. We got to go make the shuls look more palatable to the average German. We have to introduce this. We have to introduce that. And mostly, we have to start building Judaism on a rational basis, scientific, critical, rational basis. You can't have any more of this mumbo jumbo. So everything that, like, for example, kosher, come on, let's get rid of it. Mitzvahs are only really what you feel. It's not what the community tells you. Rabbi gets up here and says, you must fast on Yom Kippur. It's not something you could dictate to me. This is a personal decision that I have to make. If it talks to me, I'll do it. And one of the leading theologians was Abraham Geiger, who wrote many books among the Reform movement. He was one of the great scholars. And Shammah Fulhurst decided to battle him on their own ground. So he said, you know what? You guys are right. You're right. We need secular education. What? Yes. We need to speak German. What? We need to go out there and look presentable. You can't look like a chassid, verschlumped and walking around like this. No, you gotta speak good German, walk nicely and close, go to university, study culture. Yeah, let's listen to some Beethoven together. Let's discuss Kant over a glass of tea. But at the same time as discussing Kant, we're gonna discuss Maimonides as well. At the same time, we're gonna listen to Beethoven, we're gonna listen also to some Kolnidri. At the same time, we're gonna go out there and be good Germans and speak German. We're gonna study Chomish in German. And he wrote a commentary and a translation in German. Beautiful comment, a beautiful. And he wrote a commentary in German, and this is the way he fought them. He said, you know what? We're gonna take the best out of modernism and incorporate it within orthodoxy. But I'm not giving up orthodoxy. I'm gonna stick with orthodoxy because this is the truth. And then he wrote a book. It's interesting, if anybody has a chance to pick it up, it's called The 19 Letters. And the 19 letters is he creates a fictitious rabbinical student that writes him, Rabbi, I can't deal with orthodoxy. And he goes through a litany of questions he asks him. And Shamsul Fuller's answers, you know, piece by piece by piece by piece. It's a fascinating study, you know, within him. But that's how modern orthodoxy developed, allowing modernity to come in with certain limitations. We're not going to throw out kashrus, but at the same time, you know, we're going to be able to talk German. We're going to be able to, you know, if we sit in universities, we're going to become a doctor, and we're going to become a professor, and we'll become a lawyer. But we'll wear a yarmulke. Nothing wrong with that. You know, in the morning we'll put on tefillin, and at the same time we're going to listen to Tchaikovsky. We're going to study. We're going to study as philosophy, and we're going to study science. And you got to be the best philosopher, the best scientist, the best doctor. He pressed, because that will really impress. You know, imagine how I got so much pride out of a few weeks ago. The professor at Hebrew University, the economics professor, won the Nobel Prize, and it was a picture of him with a long gray beard with a big yarmulke. And said, oh, this was such a kiddush Hashem, such a sanctification of God's name, because here was a man that was steeped in orthodoxy, real. I mean, it wasn't fake. I mean, he had this big yarmulke with a big flowing beard, and at the same time, he won the greatest secular prize in the world. This is, you know, this is the Nobel Prize. Ah, it was so good to see that, because again, this just reiterated Shamsul Fulhurst's position of blending the two. You could go to MIT, you could go to Harvard, you could become a doctor, but you have to remain orthodox. You got it. And that came into the United States, and slowly but surely, the movement that primarily pushed this was the Young Israel movement. The Young Israel temples were what they considered modern orthodox. You know, the rabbis spoke fluent English, they went already to college, they were clean shaven, they looked more American, they wore not these big, big black yarmulkes, but knitted yarmulkes already, kind of looked a little bit more modern. You know, I mean, they could play tennis, they knew how to, you know, they looked good, athletic, you know, that's how it started. And I think that resonated with a lot of American Jews, not early on, it took them a while until they picked the pace, you know. But then when American Jews started to see, okay, look, I'm going to look at the landscape now. Reform, it's not for me, because that's too way out there. Because it's conservative, it's not. But modern Orthodox, okay, it's traditional. But at the same time, I don't have to be ashamed, you know, coming into shul and watching television or watching sports or being up on Desperate Housewives, you know, because that's all part of it. I mean, you're in culture, but you don't have to be ashamed, and you could walk, you could, you know, you could be clean shaven, you know. They, and as the movement began to move, they began to move a little bit more to the left. So, for example, in orthodoxy, mixed swimming is prohibited. Men and women don't go swimming together. Sneeze. It's modesty. But modern orthodoxy never had this problem. Yeah, why not? You know, mixed swimming, women in pants within the Hasidic and the real Litvish world, well, prohibited. In modern orthodoxy, no problem. Shorts, let's say, even covering the hair. They took out the shetel, so many modern Orthodox women don't cover their hair, except maybe when they go to shul or some of that. So they kind of picked and chosen. You know, now there is a, within the modern Orthodox movement, just like any other movement, there's a split. Because some are saying, well, hey, hold on a second. We're beginning to look conservative. I mean, you know, because now you have this organization called Eida, where, you know, and they kind of push the envelope. Now they have women's minion. They have they allow women to have their own minion. They read the Torah, the minion, everything, just like a men's minion. So they have, they, you know, you go into some shows, not all modern Orthodox shows, but some modern Orthodox shows, if you want to have a bat mitzvah, no problem. What you'll do is you'll invite all of your women friends. We'll prepare to read the Torah just like the boys will. And the fathers and the brothers and the grandfathers will sit behind the mechitza. Okay, so they'll feel like what the women feel like. You like that, right? So they have a women's, so they have a women's minion, and they daven, the whole thing would be just like the men daven, and she reads the Torah just like it would be done in a Reformed temple or conservative temple, but there's no men in the shul, and the fathers and the brothers sit, you know, behind the mechitza and play like the women would sit in the Orthodox shul. We're getting a stiff neck to see what's going on over there.
I think it's fair.
If that's what you're all about, but that's, see, they're pushing it to the, you know, because next thing, then they'll say, you know what, maybe the father could come in, and then maybe the uncle. I mean, it's a slippery pole. You know, it's a slippery pole. So some of the modern Orthodox rabbis have said, whoa, you know, I think we're letting this get out of hand, because before you know it, just like some Reform rabbis are calling the movement towards ritual, you know, we're becoming conservative light. You know, that's, we're not really Reform, because Reform always had a very specific program. This is what it is, and this is what we believe in. And now you're kind of switching it. We're starting to have rabbis put on tefillin and have people coming into shul wearing yarmulkes. Whoa, we're becoming conservative light. You know, the same thing is true on the other end of the spectrum. When modern Orthodoxy is starting to push to the left, they're also becoming a conservative light. You're not really conservative, but your ideology, your theology, kind of, you know what, you know, that. So the greatness about Judaism, and then this is true also for Christianity, because Christianity, the only one that I don't believe has yet come to that point is Islam, because Islam has not gone through a renaissance and has not gone through an enlightenment. They have to go through that process. See, Judaism, if you read the Bible, Judaism is very, very similar to Islam. God says to the people of Moses' generation, you go into the land of Israel and you massacre everybody there. Don't let anybody live. You gotta kill everybody. You walk in there and when Solomon didn't want to chop off the head of the king Agag, what happened? He lost his crown. And then Samuel took the king and right in front of everybody, beheaded him right there. Now, if I told you this was Judaism, you would say, no, Rabbi, this is not Judaism. Judaism is Kumbaya, or Shabbat Shalom. Hey, Shabbat, let's clean up the freeway. That's what Judaism is about. You cannot tell me that, you know, Joshua ordered all of the soldiers that when we take over a town, you slaughter all the men and we capture all of the women and make them into slaves. You would say, Rabbi, no, that's not Judaism. I'm sorry. Yeah, that is Judaism. I'm sorry to tell you, that's the way Judaism started. Yeah, that's where Judaism started. And Christianity was the same way. When Christianity became the official religion of the Holy Roman Empire after Constantine, it was the same way. Either you're a Christian or, see, you know, the Inquisition, all of these things. But what happened with the Catholic Church and within Judaism is they went through a period of refinement. They went through a period of enlightenment, and it showed to the world, hey, you know, hold on a second. The Gentiles are not so bad. To the Catholic Church found out that they're not the only player on the block. Now there's Protestantism. Now there's the schism within Catholicism. There's the Eastern churches. So the Pope found out early on, hey, you know what? We have to come to some kind of a reconciliation. Otherwise, we'll become totally irrelevant. So they made concessions. Don't forget, early on, Galileo was there. When they were torturing him, they were going to kill Galileo. Today, they accept Galileo, they accept the State of Israel, they do all of the things that they need to do, except certain things. But the church is understanding that. They're not fire and brimstone as they used to be. There's no more Inquisition going to happen in Peru today. You know, the Pope is not going to call for an Inquisition. The only religion that has not gone through this yet is Islam. Islam is still fighting the war of the 8th century. They're still fighting a jihad that they need to take over the world. I think Catholicism already forgot about that they're going to become the power in the world. And that's why we're dealing with two religions and two certain worlds that don't see eye to eye with each other. They don't see eye to eye. When Islam is able to calm down and make accommodations, and then the Saudi Arabians can say, yes, a church in Riyadh is not going to destroy Islam, then we can sit down and talk. But there's not one church or one synagogue in all of Saudi Arabia. Not one. Prohibited. So how can you negotiate with these kind? But that's, we're getting a far afield. We're getting into Middle East politics. But this is what modern Orthodoxy. So in America today, the greatness of this country is that everybody wins in the marketplace of ideas. I mean, if your ideas resonate with people, you're going to be around. If your market doesn't resonate with people, you'll be the shakers. And there's four left, and in 5 years there'll be zero left, and then there'll be no more shakers in the world, and no one's going to care. Completely irrelevant. And that's what the problem is within movements within Judaism as well. If you're not living with the times, if you're not moving with the times, or you're not banging out children one after another to keep reproducing the ones you're losing at the other end, you'll become irrelevant and you'll disappear, and that's the way it goes. That's the way America works. And that's true for Judaism, Christianity, deism. I mean, deism, once upon a time, this was the controlling theological movement in America. Not everybody was deist, but Thomas Jefferson was a deist, Benjamin Franklin was a deist, Thomas Paine was a deist, you know, George Washington was a deist. I mean, these guys were secular guys. They believed in somehow a mumbo jumbo, you know, natural religion, they called it. It lasted for one or two generations, and then it completely disappeared. But at that particular moment in history, they were able to create a country, and I think only because, I mean, I know a lot of people will argue with this, but only because they were secular are we able to be here today. If they had been fundamentalist Puritans, we would have been finished. We would have been out of the country like in no time. There'd be no Jews in this country. There'd probably be no Catholics in this country either. They wouldn't have let Catholics in here. They wouldn't have let Puritans, but because they didn't take religion very seriously. Mumbo jumbo, yeah, you want to believe, you don't want to believe. But what they did believe was in your right to choose. That they believed very much, in your right to choose. And they had faults. I mean, they were only human beings. I mean, no one considers Thomas Jefferson a perfect guy, or Benjamin Franklin, or George Washington. But for our purposes, they created something that we never experienced before in the history or since. You know, a place where haven, where Jews could come, and you want to daven with the Sephardim, daven with the Sephardim, you want to daven with Ashkenazim, daven Ashkenazim, you want to daven with the Litvaks. Okay, they let them in too, but what can you do this? Then you can daven with the Litvaks, Hasidim, secular humanism, you know, whatever you want, that no one's going to bother you here in this country. No one's going to bother you. So this is an experiment that has never been replicated anywhere, you know, anywhere. And not only that, but the government, you know, we're used to that if there's anti-Semitism, it's usually fueled by the government. The government is paying the people to this. And here, it's exactly the opposite. If you have an anti-Semitist, something, a swastika, immediately the government sends in the FBI. They take this to the highest level of seriousness. You know, the government, I mean, the hate crimes here in this country are looked upon terribly. When was this? I mean, we're still trying to figure out, how could this possibly be? I mean, we're used to this. The old story was, if you lived in Russia and a Russian walked by you and didn't beat you up, it was because he was lazy. That was the attitude. I mean, we're going to get beaten up, but if he doesn't, he's either drunk or lazy or not today. And here in this country, it's exactly the opposite because of Thomas. Now, what worries me a little bit is this movement here in this country. I think it's becoming too religious for me. I mean, I'm getting a little worried. You know, when Pat Robertson talks about the people in Dover that voted out those eight people because of intelligent design. Paul, is it not over yet? I want to say something. I'm holding myself back because I'm being taped over here. You know, it's not over yet? Yeah. No, that's okay. It's okay, only you have it. But you know what I always say? I always say the Baptist Convention look for intelligent design. That's the problem. I mean, it is, you know, you won't find. So, but the point is that this scares me a little bit because I like it when Christians are secular. You know what I mean? Not too religious, because when they get too religious with this Jesus business, it kind of freaks me out a little bit. It reminds me back of Eastern Europe and my forefathers, what they experienced. But when Christians are, hey, you know what, a little church is okay, you know, this is okay. But when you start fighting against stem cell research and you start introducing intelligent design in public schools and you're fighting not so much against abortion, I mean, that's that's a howitzer, but against anything, you know, I mean, just anything. And you're just fighting a war against science. I mean, this is really a war that's not, that's pitted religion versus science. It's scary a little bit to me because, you know, I like it when they're not that, you know, because once they get excited, you know, they start figuring out that like the Muslims that, man, you know, everybody's got to be like them. And we still are a minority in this country, as much as we want to believe. Now, I only figured this out 2 weeks ago. I thought, till 2 weeks ago, I thought that we were a majority. I thought there was about 117 million Jews in this country. Then I found out there were only 6 million, because I read the LA Times every two or three pages, another story about Jews. Israel has two stories, you know, some rabbi in New York story, this kind of story, that kind of story. I thought there was 117 million Jews. I found that there's only 5-6 million Jews in America. I was very disappointed.
But America did become a lot more a Christian religion.
Yeah. Well, America was always a dominant Christian religion. That would not, no one ever doubted that. But I think, well, I don't remember when I was a kid, I don't remember this display. Yeah. I mean, it works two ways. I shouldn't say that. It works both ways, because I think, even though today someone wrote an op-ed piece in the LA Times disproving what I always thought to be, they were arguing, not disproving, they were arguing, they say there's not this great divide, you know, within the country, because we talked after the last election, the big word was, oh, look at the cultural divide. You either have the two coasts, New York, California, that are representing the blue states, and then you have, you know, Jesus America. Anything under the Mason-Dixon line is all red, and that's all, you know, Jesus country. And in the north, you have, like, you know, places, a few secular, like Chicago maybe, you know, here and there, pockets, you know, that, and there's a big divide. So this guy wrote today, I forgot who it was, I think Neil Ferguson, that there isn't this big divide. Come on, let's be honest, because, you know, we elected a Republican mayor in New York, so even New York, the strength of the Republican, whatever it is. But I find that there's two interesting things happening at the same time. On one hand, we were talking about how in yesteryear there was never a problem of talking, saying Merry Christmas. You walked into a store, they said Merry Christmas to you. Everybody said Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. Today, can't say that. Today you have to say Happy Holidays, because you don't know who you're talking to. So today you say Happy Holidays. Matter of fact, a Walmart fired one of its employees because it answered an email when someone said, why do you say Happy Holidays? So he said, because Christmas is a bogus holiday. It comes anyways from paganism, and, you know, and what's Christmas is not Christmas. They fired him on the spot. You're out. So therefore, Happy Holidays. Today you have to say Happy Holidays. Today you can't put a creche, you know, anywhere, because that's not politically correct. When I was a kid, you put the creche. People had creches, people had this. We understood quietly that this is a Christian country, and we are here visitors, and we're Jews, and we're welcome visitors, and we're good Americans. But you know what? Christmas is Christmas, and let them have their holiday. Not today. Today we're going to root out everything that's politically incorrect. So we take out God out of the public schools. Okay, so that's one thing. That's one thing that's happening. Second thing that's happening is that in certain parts of this country, not everywhere, but the Christian right has become emboldened. They think, you know, this started with Ronald Reagan, I believe. You know, it started with Ronald Reagan, that they become much more emboldened and become much more politically involved. As a matter of fact, interestingly enough, that if you ever watch in the morning, the talking heads, there's a guy, Jay Sekulow. You ever see this guy? He is their lawyer for the Christian right. He's a Jew who converted to Christianity. He heads one of these American centers for law and justice. So, you know, that's called the American Center for Law and Justice. And he fights every battle for the Christian right, whether it's putting a creche on public property, whether it's abortion, or whether it's defending these wacko guys that shoot abortion on it. He's at the center. Terry Schiavo case, he was at the center. You know, Jay Sekulow is his name. And he's a Jewish boy. I mean, he looks like a Jew, speaks like a Jew, but he converted to Christianity. That movement has become more emboldened. I don't remember, you know, seeing so much talk of Jesus. Everybody talking about Jesus, you know, all of that stuff today. So we have, I think, these two things that are going on. One hand, we want vanilla. The official thing is we don't want anybody sticking out. We want a vanilla kind of tariff. You know, don't say happy, don't say Merry Christmas. We want to make everybody happy. At the same time, we have this movement, the underlying movement, that is more emboldened, fighting against who would have ever thought when I was a kid that you're going to fight to put intelligent design in public school? This was delegated to a private school. You want to talk about God? Go to church. Go to yeshiva. They'll talk about God. Separation of church and state. But today, it's not so. They're kind of encroaching little by little. Now, the people are going to say, hey, Rabbi, our best friends, who supports Israel more than anybody else in this country, who's Israel's best friend? And I agree, and I admit, it's the Pat Robertsons, the Jerry Falwells, it's these guys that pump money into Israel, they go to Israel, Tom DeLay, you know, the guy Tom DeLay, who was the Pasconiak, that was indicted, he was Israel's strongest ally on the hill. There was no one stronger, more pro-Israel on the hill than Tom DeLay. As a matter of fact, he went to Israel, I remember 2 years ago, and in the Knesset, he said, I don't understand. Here I am, an American Christian, have to tell you Jews not to give land back to the Arabs? I have to be the one that tells you to not to give them any land, that they don't deserve any land? You know, okay, thank you very much. So that was, so I understand that, and I appreciate that. And I say, let's take all their money. Well, I got no problem. If Pat Robertson says to me, Rabbi, I want to build you a shul. Pat, this is my wiring information. This is my bank account. Here, send it in. I don't care. But at the same time, we need to know that there's two things working here. We got to be smart. There's two things working at the same time. They're supporting Israel, but at the same time, they're fighting a cultural war here in the United States that makes me feel a little uncomfortable. Other Jews don't feel discomfort. Man, they don't care, you know, about this. You know what I mean? Abortion, we should be against abortion. I know, but I don't want the government telling me what. I know I'm against abortion. I don't need the government to tell me that I can't have an abortion. Not me. I'm never going to have an abortion. But, you know, my daughter or somebody else's daughter. But that's... How do we get into this? I'm soon going to be investigated by the IRS. What did you get me into if you're asking me these political charges questions? The next thing you know, the IRS is going to be down here. The rabbi was against the Christian right. We should take away his IRS status and exemption.
That's why they support Israel, is because when it's Israel, yeah, the Jews return.
Yeah, Jesus is coming. Yeah, the Messiah comes. Which, you know what, I don't care. The truth of the matter is, I don't care. You see, Israel is so isolated in the world that I don't care if Pat Robertson believes that. What do I care? His money goes towards building homes. And Chuck Smith here, Chuck Smith is a pastor right here in Costa Mesa. He built the Calvary Church. Calvary Church is a huge chain of churches, even though they're independently owned and operated, you know, but he was the one that founded this movement. It's one of the most fundamentalist Christian churches. It is what they call, like, almost, it's not charismatic, it's not Pentecostal, but they're passionate. I mean, you know, you go to their churches, they're real Christians. They have Bibles in their hands and they're thumping for Jesus, baby. You know, he goes to Israel every year with $1 million check from his church. They collect every year, one Sunday. Today's take is going to go for the state of Israel and for our Jewish brothers and sisters. And he flies to Israel, meets with the prime minister, shakes his hand. There's the check for $1 million from the Calvary Church. And he gives
That's
it to them.
The goal?
Well, the goal is they believe firmly that Israel needs to exist. The Jews need to keep Israel strong because that's a precursor for Jesus coming back. And when Jesus comes back, then, you know what? So they...
Either we convert or they kill us.
Either they convert or we kill us. You know what? So they asked somebody, I think it was Morton Klein from ZOA, Zionist Organization of America, but some very right-wing Zionist movement that held a press conference with Pat Robertson. And the reporter asked him, they said, Mr. Klein, don't you realize that Pat Robertson has an agenda? He wants the Jews to be strong, Israel to be strong, and then Jesus will come back. So his answer was, if Jesus comes back, then we're all in trouble. What do I care? If he's right, what's going to happen? I'm taking his money. Okay, so one of two things happen. Messiah comes. If he happens to be Lubavitch Rebbe, Pat Robertson is in big trouble. If it happens to be Jesus, we're in big trouble. Okay, so we shouldn't take his money because Pat Robertson... So that was his way of justifying it. And I agree with him. I have to say I agree with him, even though I'm leery of his agenda. And he's a whacked guy. I mean, the guy's cracked. I mean, what this guy says, like, he's advocating to kill Hugo Chavez in Venezuela. He's the guy, he's advocating that something is going to happen bad. And
what's
things
scarier, there are a lot of people,
who believe
ordinary
him.
People,
yeah,
that feel this way.
Right, yeah, they are. We don't feel it because we live in California. It's still a little Michigan. Here we have the nuts and the fruits and the crackpots over here, you know, in California. But if you go to the deep South, this is what they believe.
Have you talked to Southern Baptists in the South?
Not the only time I met a few of them was at a convention. I spent a month in New York when I was trained for Dean Witter, and there were some from Alabama and Texas that I got pretty friendly with. They are funny guys.
They're worse than, they're not funny. They're serious.
No, they're serious.
And
they're serious.
I talked to some, and you know, I mean, I'm a Jew. Oh my God, this is horrible. It doesn't, you know, I mean, they were working on me. And,
yeah, but they want to convert. But I'll tell you one thing. You go out here in California, and you hear, "Hey, Rabbi, I'm with the State of Israel. I'm backing them." Good chance that this is a fundamentalist Christian. Okay. We'll say that. Because they now are starting to buy into this idea that Israel needs to exist, Jews need to be in Israel, and it's certainly not for the mainline churches, because they happen to be one more very anti, I mean, Episcopalians and the Methodists, I mean, they're very anti-Israel. So you won't hear that from an Episcopalian, but if you will hear it from those guys who are carrying the Bible, "Rabbi, we're with you," I hear it all the time here. We're back Israel 100%. They're more anti-Arab than we are. I mean, we try to appease them. They don't see, why do you have to appease them for? They don't see any room, no room for, you know, they're still fighting. To these guys, it's still the days of the Crusades.
How many of them will turn around, when you walk away, will turn around and call you whatever?
Yeah, I'm sure there are some of them. I think everybody, in that case, everybody then will turn around and call you. I don't think the liberals of Massachusetts are any different. I lived in Boston, and they're the same way. I think if you just, because a guy's in Harvard, is not going to make him any more Jew-friendly than the guy down in the South. I don't think so. I think the left have it out for Israel, and the right have it out for Israel. Except that right now, the right, at least openly, I'm not saying what's doing and lurking in the hearts of man, is this segment is more pro-Israel than the left is in this country. And every time I want to kind of steer myself to join whatever movement, whether it's Cindy Sheehan or some other guy, it always comes attached with anti-Zionism.
Yeah.
Every time it's the same story. Yeah. I want to become an anti-war activist, but every time I go to a rally, it turns out to be anti-Israel, anti-Bush. What does Israel have to do with this?
Yeah.
This is not, this has nothing to do with Israel. So that's my problem with this segment. I mean, I like a Democrat like Scoop Jackson. He was my type of Democratic senator from Washington. He was tough on foreign policy, the Jackson-Vanik Amendment. You know, he understood the importance of Israel. But at the same time, he was a Democrat. You know, he understood that socially, you got to loosen up. But the left wing, this extreme left wing, just the Michael Moore scare me more than the right scare me. Because they can envision a world without Israel. And them, they could envision. To Michael Moore, if Israel disappeared, I don't think we could care less. He could care less, because to him, Israel is an occupational army, in his mind. And therefore, I can't get my arms around this. Even she, I felt for her. I felt, and she had the best cause in the world. Her son had died, and she was supporting an unpopular. She was advocating against an unpopular war and an unpopular president. But then all of a sudden you turn around, and who's she surrounding herself with?
They took her over.
They took her over. She was way over her head.
Yeah.
And then that's why she lost my support. The moment she started to talk about my son didn't die for Israel, my son was an American, I mean, that was it, finished, Gamarno, thank you very much. And the same thing is, even this pastor here, when I read about the All Saint Church in Pasadena, where the IRS, when we were talking about this month, the office, so I read his transcript. He kept referring to it as Israel-Palestine. He couldn't say the word Israel. He always kept referring to that part of the world as Israel-Palestine, Israel, and that lost me. What do you mean Israel-Palestine? There's no Palestine. We're negotiating a Palestinian state right now, but there's Israel. No, he couldn't say it. It was Israel-Palestine, Israel-Palestine. All through the speech, he was talking about how Bush has ruined the world and in Iraq and in Afghanistan and Israel-Palestine. What's Israel-Palestine? I don't see anywhere there's a place called Israel-Palestine. And that's where they lose me. That's where the left loses me. And I can't buy into that. We went far afield of talking about Hasidim with black hats to blasting Michael Moore. But you know what? It's all in a day's work, right? That's what they say.
This is very enjoyable.
What?
Yes.
Is it 10 o'clock? 10 to 10?
Yeah.
Boy, oh boy. So we talked about a lot of different issues tonight, but you know, Judaism will live on. I mean, I'm not too worried about Judaism. I think it will always be here around, at least through my lifetime. The only thing that we have to do is that what I worry about is our waning influence. That's what I worry about more than anything. That there will be a pocket of Jews in New York. Nah, I'm sure that they will exist. But our strength is at least the Gentiles think in their minds, oh, the Jews are powerful. Whether we are or not, whether we're organized or not, I'll never forget, and you know, we'll end with this, and I know we gotta get home. I had once had the opportunity of having lunch with, do you remember there was a pastor of the AME church, he just retired.
Downtown LA.
I keep saying his name, but he was visiting a Jewish friend of his up down here in Belmont Shore. So he said, he called me up by this mutual friend, and he said, would you like to have lunch with Pastor, I'm going to remember his name when I would tell the story. So I said, well, how often do I get to meet this pastor from the AME church and think? I said, listen, I won't eat lunch because I'm sure you're not bringing kosher, but I'll just sit there and we'll schmooze with him. Okay, I come in there, it's me, this Jewish friend of mine, and six African-American guys sitting around the table, because he travels with his entourage. Doesn't travel alone, he travels with an entourage, a couple of black women in the room. Okay, I sit down, he sits down, he greets me, how's it going, Rabbi, everything's good. They're eating, I'm eating, then he turns around to me and he says, Rabbi, I'd like to know your opinion of Louis Farrakhan. Oy. Oy, oy, oy. The first question hits me with the first question on the thing. Oy, 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 oy. So I think of second, I say, listen, what can I do?
Nice tie.
What?
He wears a nice tie.
He wears a nice bow tie. You know, I say, you know what? What am I going to lose? What? I said, you know what? At first I thought I'm going to pussyfoot around the answer. That's African American. These guys are African American. But I figured, what do I have to lose? I mean, which guy's not going to beat me up here? So, I hope not, at least. I'm going to beat me up. I said, I can't stand Louis Farrakhan. I think he's a hater, and he's terrible. He says, Rabbi, and he pauses, I couldn't agree with you more. He's a divider, and we need to shut him out of our community. We need to, you know, whew. I said, wow. And then we had a nice discussion around, well, you know, what you do, what I do. Then as we were walking out, I said, Reverend, how many members do you have in your congregation? He said, 17,000. 17,000 members in the church, okay? 17,000 members in the church. And then he turns to me and he says, Rabbi, I trade them all for 1,000 Jews. And I said, really, Reverend? He said, yeah, because you guys are organized. You know how to get things done. You know how to band together when it needs to be. But yes, it's all, everybody's on their own. No one can talk two words. So I said to myself, ha ha, if only he knew. If only he knew what's going on in the Jewish community. He wouldn't trade them for three Jews. He wouldn't trade them for 300,000 Jews. He wouldn't trade them. But in his mind, he thought that Jews, if something needs to get done for Israel, we call a meeting. We need to raise $25 million. Immediately, Spielberg writes at $5 million, Eisner writes at $5 million, and in 5 seconds, you have $25 million, and it's done. He doesn't know that every Jew hates the other Jew, that we're all, you know, we're only talking to each other because of necessity, because on all of that stuff. But that's really, that was his feeling. And then he said, Rabbi, as he was getting into his car, and this is what makes a man like him versus anybody else. And he said, Rabbi, lead us in prayer. Lead us in prayer. I'm used to Baruch Atah Hashem, Baruch Pri Hagafen. I mean, that's not what he was talking about. They have this instantaneous prayers. I said, Reverend, in your presence, how can I lead us in prayer? So we all held hands there, and I thought, well, this is, if my father could see me now, you know, then he would be so proud of me. If my teachers in Yeshiva in Montreal could just see me now with six months, standing in Long Beach, downtown Long Beach, holding hands, and he's
having
a meeting, and he's standing over there, and in a second, he gave this prayer, and it was this profound. On this spot, we today are building a new union, a comradeship between Rabbi and Reverend, that one day will rise up and to show the world that we, So where's Martin Luther King? Where's Martin Luther King? But this guy had the power of the speech. This guy could get up there, and in a second, he created a prayer that I almost signed up on the dotted line. If he said, Rabbi, a donation, here's $25, just for that prayer. But he was a special person. I mean, everybody in LA who knew this guy knew that he's really something special, that he was able to, you know, to live, you know, it's a tough gig. I mean, it's a tough gig. You're one of the biggest black churches, and every pronouncement that you make has tremendous ramifications. I mean, you're talking to literally tens of thousands of people every Sunday morning, and very powerful guy. And, you know, he was able to build bridges with the Hispanic community and the white community and the Jew. You know, he was kind of a special guy. He's retired now. They retired him after, I think, 27 or 28 years. And that's it. All right, Paul. We're done. Thank you very much for coming this evening.
Thank you so much.